what he's doing sometimes, Kim. Sorry.
I could resist.
Good morning, everyone. We'll go ahead and get started. A copy of the Open Meeting Act is located on the north wall of the legislative chambers, and an automatic external defibrillator is available on the back wall of the legislative chambers. Please stand for the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
This week, we are also, during National County Government Awareness Month, recognizing county employees that have been completing 35 to 39 years of service with us. And so I'm going to ask that we go into our County Board of Commissioners meeting, recognize the employees, and then we'll recess and go back to the original agenda. So please roll call for the Douglas County Board of Commissioners.
Commissioner Boyle, Commissioner Duda, Commissioner Kraft, Commissioner Morgan, Commissioner Rogers, Commissioner Tusha,
here.
Madam Chair.
Here. Item recognition and proclamations is the recognition of the county employees completing 35 to 39 years of service with the county, and here to present those is Leela Shear, our community.
Thank you.
Director.
Good morning, county board members. Leela Shear, Civil Service Commission, HR Director. Today we're having a second part of our County Government Awareness Month program to recognize our employees for their dedicated service to Douglas County. This is part of the service award program that was approved by the county board back on March 18th of this year. And today, as Commissioner Borgeson mentioned, we're recognizing those employees with 35 to 39 years. We have a total of seven individuals to recognize today, and their names are Dennis Yeaman of the Sheriff's Office, Susan Hurd of the Assessor's Office, Norma Drake of the Health Center, Mike Havlick of the District Court's Office, Larry Thompson of the Assessor's Office, John Rocky Rockefort of the Corrections Department, and Alan Agosta of the Engineer's Office. And on today's board agenda, there is a resolution on each individual to officially recognize their dedicated service to Douglas County. At this point, I would ask the board to now consider the resolution honoring each of these individuals.
Motion approved.
Second.
Please vote.
Motion passes.
Okay. Thank you, and I will now ask the following employees to please come forward with their elected official or department head and any family members that came with them today or friends to receive their resolution thanking them for their years of service. Their elected official department may say a few words about them as an employee of the county. We'll start with individuals with 35 years of service and then move up toward our most senior employee. The first one we'd like to recognize is John Rocky Rockefort of the Corrections Department with 35 years of service.
You want to say something for yourself? We'll be happy yourself.
I'll just thank the county board for putting up with me for 35 years. And the county has been good to me. I can remember the late Charlie Terry told me the first day of our class when I started in 1979, the county's been good to me. And I think after 35 years, I can say the same thing.
Thank you.
Well, I can say that I've known him since I've walked in the door. So, and it's been a long, well, mine's about 34, but 35 years. But I'll tell you, from the first time I met him with his Afro-style haircut and full hair and mustache a little bit here and there once in a while, but and the way he responded to codes and stuff, I'll tell you what, one of his best attributes is the fact that he can diffuse about 99.9% of any issue that arises in the facility, whether it's inmates, staff, or management. He's really good at his speech. He talks really well, and you know, I learned a lot from him myself going up the ranks, just by the way he talks to people and the way he treats people. And when he gets upset, it's for a very, very short time, and he moves on. And he's really good at what he does, you know, and he is an asset to the department. And I can truly say that he helped mentor me where I'm at with my dialogue. So,
thank you.
Good morning, Commissioners. Mark Foxhall, Director of Corrections, and certainly have to stand before you today and say some kind things about Lieutenant John Rockerford. I've known Rocky, as we know him around the facility, since I was a freshman in high school, approximately 10 or 15 years ago. So, but one of the things that I remember from that day is, and he was an upperclassman and we were underclassmen, when the upperclassmen typically picked on the incoming freshman, not Rocky. Rocky looked out for us, made sure that we weren't unduly picked on by the upperclassmen, and really took an interest in the smooth transition from grade school into high school. He took us under his wing, and I remember that. I remember the big smile on his face. I remember the huge heart that he had all those years ago. And when I came to work for Douglas County reacquainted myself with Rocky, he had the same big smile on his face. He had the same can-do attitude. He had the same big heart. And with all these years and a really, really tough job assignment, he's not jaded. He still has a good, positive attitude. And I think one of the good things I like about him is, his boss, I got this. He says, if I don't have this, I'll let you know. He says, relax. And having good, competent people working for the county, and particularly in a tough job assignment such as what we are tasked with, you folks can be very, very proud of Lieutenant Rockerford and the service that he's provided over all these years. I take my hat off to him, and I stand before you every month, as you well know, and talk about the different things that we have to encounter. Rocky's our B-shift watch commander, and that's one of our busiest times of a 24-hour period, is when you got a lot of movement coming and going, and you know what's coming in that back door, and people aren't always at their best. And Lieutenant John Rockerford handles his business, and if he needs me, he calls me, keeps us apprised of what's going on. And just in closing, you got one of the best working for you right here in the county. Hats off to John Rockerford. Congratulations on a long career, and I hope we have you around for many more years.
Thank
Okay, our next recipient is Larry Thompson, an assessor's office with 36 years of service. Larry?
Madam Chair, members of the County Board, I first met Larry actually at UNO. We were taking real estate classes together. And after that, when I got my appraiser's license, whenever I went down to the Register of Deeds office, I found out he was the go-to guy. I mean, he knew the business. He knew how to cut to the chase. He'd already been there, I don't know how many, you know, probably 5 or 6 years. I don't know. A long time, or so he thought. And after I was elected as assessor, I passed him in the halls one day, and I said, Larry, how'd you like a job? And we had some appraisal jobs posted. And knowing that he had the background in appraisal and that he had some good history with the county that he could bring to the assessor's office, he said, well, I don't know, what do you got? And it led to him being hired in the assessor's office and working his way up to senior residential manager. And what he does is, he's the guy that goes down to the Turk and defends the county on the residential side. I'm real proud of Larry. He's an asset to the assessor's office, to Douglas County, and really to the voters and property owners of Douglas County. So thank you, Larry.
Thank you. Sounds like quite a history he's reciting there, but as he said earlier, we've known each other since before I had gray hair and when he still had hair. So, just thank you for this award. I know there's a number of us in this old-timer category that appreciate the recognition, and just thank you very much.
I might add that Larry's leaving on vacation later today, and he's going to Boston. He did the Boston Marathon with a visually impaired person last year. I mean, he didn't run it, but he ran part of it with him. And he's going to run the 5K race as part of the Boston Marathon. So when he's looking good for an old guy, isn't he?
Very, very good.
Our next recipient is Mike Havlick of the District Court's Office with 36 years of service.
Madam Chair, Commissioners, as a Douglas County employee, it has been my privilege to work with and learn from the District Court judges, the District Court administrator, and all of my colleagues on the District Court staff. Thank you.
Good morning.
Morning.
Doug Johnson, District Court Administrator. First, on behalf of the District Court and District Court judges, thank you for this recognition of Mike. Mike has been a Deputy Court Administrator and has held that position for 15 years. And Mike started 35 years ago as a law clerk in Douglas County for the court. I have a few job functions that Mike performs just so you know what he does around here. He manages the jury selection for all 16 courtrooms, prepares the jury call-in schedule for all prospective jurors. He's the main contact for jury instructions for all judges and attorneys statewide. He prepares the quarterly financial statement for the 40 child support program and assists me in the day-to-day activities, especially preparing correspondence to the various agencies we deal with. Mike, congratulations on 35 years.
Thank you, it's my privilege.
Mike is truly an asset to the District Court and the citizens of Douglas County. Thank you. I forgot his wife Kathy's here today also, and we got some folks from the court administrator's office also joined us.
Where's Kathy?
Okay, our next recipient is Sue Hurd of the assessor's office with 39 years of service.
Again, when I was elected in 1999, Sue had just moved from the treasurer's office into the assessor's office and was in charge of mobile homes. And she was a clerk. And I'm proud to say with her hard work, this is where you can really tell when somebody is really dedicated to what they do and they're good at what they do. She's worked her way up to being the office manager. And I will say that she's tough because if one of the other supervisors come and wants something in the office, no, we're not going to spend money on that. We're going to. So if we do have any surplus this year, she's the young lady that's a credit to that. And I'm proud to somebody that's worked real hard, been very conscientious, loves her job. I'm also very proud of Sue And she also is a credit to the assessor's office, to Douglas County, and all the property owners and taxpayers in Douglas County. Thanks, Sue.
Thank you. I want to thank Roger. He's wonderful to work for, and all you commissioners that given me the recognition of 39 years. I do want you to know I was 12 when I started, so I just, you know, I want you guys to know that. So you're not calculating like last week going, now I can figure this out. So yes, I was 12. That's what I tell everybody. Over my 39 years, I've met wonderful people. I've worked with so many people, and I love working for the assessor's office. I started with Frank Bemis. My 2 weeks out of high school, my dad told me I had to get a job. I got on the MAP bus, came, worked in the as a clerk in the motor vehicle department. 39 years later, here I am. So it's wonderful. Thank you so very much for everything. Roger, thank you.
Our last recipient today is Dennis Yeaman, a deputy sheriff with the sheriff's office with 39 years of service.
Good morning, Commissioners. Tim Dunning, Douglas County Sheriff. It's been an honor and a privilege for me the last 20 years to work with Deputy Dennis Yeaman. Over the course of his career, he's worked in the courts, he's worked on road patrol, worked in criminal investigation, worked in warrants, I believe, for a short stint. And in my mind, I guess, and just to probably quote a caption that I put on his last performance evaluation, that I've always felt that he was a role model for other members of our department. He said he's sensitive, he's firm, and he's always capable. And I think that embodies what we hope we hire every time we hire a deputy. So along with you, congratulate him on attaining. Next month, he'll reach the rule of 100. So anybody that thinks that you're not getting your money out of the pension system, we thank Dennis for all of his extra contributions.
I didn't know I was going to have to say anything at this ceremony, but I appreciate the kind words the sheriff said about me. I started 29 May 1975 with Sheriff Ted Janning then. He was on his last term, and Sheriff Dick Roth for those four terms, and now Sheriff Dunning, and I've done my best to protect and serve and do it with integrity and honor, and I appreciate it, and thank you.
This will conclude our awardees today. We'd like to thank those who are especially honored today and all our employees for the dedicated service of Douglas County. And our next board meeting will have another group of employees to be recognized. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Lee. And again, thank you all for being here. This is one of those, it really is a neat part of the job to see people who have been here for a long time and being able to recognize all of you. So thank you for your service to Douglas County. We will have a motion to recess the County Board of Commissioners and go to the Board of Equalization.
Second.
Roll call, please vote.
Commissioner Morgan? Motion passes.
The agenda for the Douglas County Board of Equalization, roll call, please.
Commissioner Boyle, Commissioner Duda, Commissioner Kraft, Commissioner Morgan, Commissioner Rogers, Commissioner Tusha, Madam Chair.
here. Item A, approval of the minutes of the Board of Equalization meeting held Tuesday, April 8th, 2014. And item B, call for a meeting and set Tuesday, April 29th, 2014 as a date for hearing on certified assessment corrections reflecting the addition of omitted property to the tax rolls or increased value on property.
Approve A and B.
Any questions or comments? Please vote.
Motion passes.
Item C, citizen comments. Is there anyone in the chamber wishing to speak to the Board of Equalization about an item not on the agenda? Seeing none, we'll move to resolutions. There are three. Item D, we will take separately. Item resolution E is approving application for tax exemptions on motor vehicles recommended for approval by the county treasurer. And item F is denial of these applications for tax exemptions on these motor vehicles recommended by approval by the county treasurer.
Motion to approve E and F.
Any questions or comments? Please vote.
Motion passes.
We'll go back to item D, denial of the 2014 real estate and personal property permissive exemption application, Woodman of the World Life Insurance Society and Woodman of the World Centennial Lodge 16. This was a carryover from our April 8th, 2014 meeting. And with us today is Ms. Dobson from our county attorney's office, and she will start off the presentation. And I am going to allow a little bit additional time for this particular item, as again it's carried over from the April 8th with the understanding that we would have further discussion on it.
Thank you.
Good morning.
Thank you, Madam Chair, members of the County Board. Good morning. I'm Melina Dobson, Deputy County Attorney. It's April 15th, tax day. And one thing I imagine that's worse than doing your taxes is listening to a bunch of lawyers argue about them. But that's what we're in for today. So before you, you have two things. One is a simple one-page handout of the two statutes that we'll be discussing today.
Thank you.
And the other is a copy of the PowerPoint presentation so that you may follow along and take notes if you wish. The issue before the county attorney's office is whether Woodman of the World qualifies for a property tax exemption. And when I was asked to develop an opinion on this question, our goal was not to advocate for any specific position, but to just really research the law with an open mind. Excuse me? Oh, sorry. And with an open mind and try to determine an accurate understanding and construction of the law. And so with that, we've relied on 44-1095. Now, interestingly, as you heard Mr. Goodwillie say a few weeks ago, prior to this year, 44-1095 was not on our radar. Actually, it was a conversation that Mr. Goodwillie had with the Nebraska Department of Revenue, where they brought that law to our attention. And that's really significant because 44-1095, as you can see from your handout, exempts fraternals from many taxes other than taxes on real estate and office equipment, which is the specific issue for which we're here today. Now, you'll see that it says in that 44-1095, every society organized or licensed under some specific sections. Now, that's not at issue today. Woodman of the World, as they told you a few weeks ago, is a fraternal benefit society, and they are organized under those sections. So the real issue is their exemption status. Now, conversely, Woodman of the World is relying upon 77-202. 77-202 is a much more broad statute. It's an umbrella statute, and under that umbrella can follow any type of charity that's seeking a property tax exemption, as opposed to 44-1095, which is narrowed down strictly to fraternal benefit societies. Now, this is really the crux of the Douglas County Attorney's analysis. 77-202 is broad and can apply to any charity as long as it follows the definition provided in 77202, whereas 44-1095 deals solely with fraternal benefit societies. And legislature told us how to treat taxes on real estate. Fraternals are exempt from all and every state, county, district, municipal, and school tax other than taxes on real estate and office equipment. Now, in because we have two statutes that deal with the same material, whether or not to provide a property tax exemption, the Nebraska Supreme Court has told us how to resolve any potential conflicts when we have those two statutes dealing with the same material. And the rule is the general law yields to the specific law. Now, this is such a well-settled rule of law that it didn't surprise me that I found an instance where Woodman themselves cited this law. But what did surprise me was that I found a case so directly on point where Woodman cited this law and, in essence, agreed with the county attorney's position today. Now, the case is the Colorado Department of Revenue versus Woodman of the World. So Woodman of the World was seeking a tax exemption in Colorado, much like they're seeking a tax exemption here today. Now, the parallels are numerous between that case and the case here today. In Colorado, they have a version of 44-1095. They have a version that's virtually identical that exempts fraternals from virtually all taxes other than taxes on real estate and office equipment. Then they have a statute that exempts charities that are used exclusively for charitable purposes from paying sales tax. And so the issue in that case, the one big difference is that that was sales tax and this is property tax. But the two statutes are very similar that we're comparing. And what's really important to note is that in that case, Woodman argued that Colorado's version of 44-1095 was more specific than the umbrella statute defining charities for the purpose of an exemption and thus control. So, if you look at, I believe it's approximately slide four, you'll see the quote from the Colorado Supreme Court. Woodman also relies on the familiar principle that in case of conflict, a specific statute prevails over a general one. Now, you're going to hear that today from Woodman's counsel, and you're going to hear that 77202 is more specific. But you see that when it benefited Woodman for the statute from the insurance chapter, they argued that that statute that dealt specifically with fraternals was the more specific statute. Now, the Colorado Supreme Court ultimately did not decide the case on this issue. They denied the exemption on another basis. But it's important to note that Woodman argued this principle. So, a few weeks ago, now this is difficult to see on the screen, but it's easier to see on your handout. This is a printout of the titles from the Colorado statutes. I apologize. That's page six. Sure. So if you look there at the titles, Title 10 says insurance, and Title 39 says taxation. Now, a few weeks ago, Woodman's counsel told you that when you have a taxation statute in conflict with an insurance statute, you must look to the taxation statute. Well, in this Colorado case, that was precisely what was in conflict, and Woodman argued the opposite, that you look to the insurance statute because it's more specific. So I can't emphasize that enough, that because that really is the crux of our position. The statutes dealing specifically with fraternals are the guiding principle of our analysis. And at one point, when it benefited Woodman, they agreed. Now, we'll continue now to page seven, the rules of statutory analysis. In addition to the specific versus general rule that I spoke about, the Nebraska Supreme Court has told us that we must give the law its plain and ordinary meaning. Now, if you look at your handout with the statutes, and you see that legislature determined that every society organized or licensed under those sections shall be a charitable and benevolent institution, and all of its funds shall be exempt from all and every state, county, district, municipal, and school tax, other than taxes on real estate and office equipment. The plain and ordinary meaning is that legislature intended that fraternal benefit societies do not qualify for property tax exemptions. If you look up the words other than, if for some reason you needed to look up those words in the Webster's Dictionary, it says except for. So there's no provision for a property tax exemption. Now, another rule of statutory analysis is that we must presume legislative knowledge. By that, what I mean is when 44-1095, the statute specific to fraternals, came into existence, 77-202 was already on the books. And it would have been very easy for legislature to put in 44-1095, other than taxes on real estate. For taxes on real estate, you need to look to 77-202. But they didn't do that. They stopped. They simply said, other than taxes on real estate, omitting a possibility of an exemption. Thus, this rule, again, presuming legislative knowledge, lends itself to the county attorney's opinion that 44-1095 is a guiding principle. Additionally, statutory exceptions must be strictly construed. And in this case, Woodman has the burden of proving that they should receive an exemption. So not only do they have the burden, but we must strictly look at the language of 44-1095 and not extend it by construction, not read into it beyond its plain and ordinary meaning. Now, according to Woodman, 44-1095 somehow leaves the door open for a 77-202 analysis. In Woodman's brief, they stated that 44-1095 merely states that Woodman is not exempted from certain other taxes. The question becomes whether Woodman qualifies for a property tax exemption under 77-202, to paraphrase. That's not the plain meaning of 44-1095. There's no reference to 77-202. And we simply cannot extend the meaning of 44-1095 by construction. Now, even though the Douglas County Attorney's Office is confident in its position that 44-1095 guides our analysis, even if we did have to do an analysis under 77-202, that analysis would be problematic for Woodman for a few reasons, and I've highlighted those on your handout. Under 77-202, a charity must be used exclusively for a charitable purpose. We'll find that that's not the case with Woodman. It must not be owned or used for the financial gain or profit to either owner or user. There's some evidence that that may be occurring with Woodman. And finally, another problematic section is that the organization must be operated exclusively for the purpose of the mental, social, or physical benefit of the public or an indefinite number of persons. Now, we'll begin first with the exclusivity argument. The Nebraska Supreme Court has differentiated between a business that has some charitable activities incidentally and a business which its dominant purpose is charitable activities. Woodman's dominant purpose is the selling of insurance. And as we relied on our original memo to the assessor's office, we relied on the case of Royal Highlanders versus the state. And this is a Nebraska Supreme Court case, which, as Woodman pointed out, is an old case. I've spoken with the Nebraska Department of Revenue, and the Nebraska Department of Revenue was very clear. They're not taking a position in this matter. However, the first case that they pointed me to was Royal Highlanders, and I disagree respectfully with Woodman that this case is not good law anymore. This case is directly on point with the analysis because it points out that what Woodman has with its members is a contractual relationship. If you pay for insurance, you get your insurance. If you stop paying, you don't get your benefit, and your beneficiaries don't get your benefit. That's a business model. That's not a charitable organization. Now, that was from the Nebraska Supreme Court. They determined that fraternal benefit societies, as a rule, they're not used exclusively under 77202 for charitable purposes. Now, the Colorado case that I mentioned earlier also addresses the exclusivity analysis. And although cases from Colorado, they're not binding on this board, they are persuasive. And it's especially persuasive because, again, Woodman was the party seeking the exemption. And in the Colorado case, the Colorado Supreme Court found that although fraternal benefit societies may engage in some charitable activities, which you will hear a lot about, the $40 million plus in charitable activities from Woodman, they are not organized and operated exclusively for those purposes, but instead are formed to provide various insurance benefits for their members and the beneficiaries of their members. So that was what the Colorado Supreme Court found in analyzing whether they were exclusively charitable. Now, yes, that was a case about sales tax as opposed to property tax, but the definition for charitable purposes was quite similar. They had to analyze exclusivity, and they found that Woodman was not exclusively charitable. The Colorado Supreme Court specifically noted that even though such organizations had been legislatively characterized as charitable and benevolent institutions under their version of 44-1095, that didn't satisfy the definition under the sales tax statute. Now, this is extremely significant because a few weeks ago you heard that the Douglas County Attorney's Office is ignoring the charitable designation under 44-1095, and we're ignoring the charitable designation from the IRS. However, charitable designations in one statute or from one form of government aren't necessarily transferable to other statutes. And that's why 77202 has a specific definition of what is required to be charitable under that statute. So we aren't ignoring it, it's just not transferable. And the Colorado Supreme Court noted in those two very similar statutes, even though the legislature said you're charitable for the purpose of the insurance chapter, you don't fit this definition of charitable under the Sales Tax Act. So again, very parallel to the case before us. This is just some additional language from that Colorado Supreme Court case. And the important language from the Colorado Supreme Court is that, quote, "This is a strong indication that the legislature did not contemplate an exemption based on charitable character for entities such as Woodman, whose organization and operation is not so limited." So once again, in a different way, they're saying Woodman is not exclusively limited to charitable work. Now we've discussed the exclusivity requirement of 77202, and we'll briefly talk about two other problematic areas. First, 77202 requires their benefit to be offered to the public or an indefinite number of persons. Now, the benefit of the insurance policies goes to the members and the beneficiaries of those members for Woodman of the World. As I mentioned, if a member stops paying, the beneficiary doesn't get a charitable payout. This is a contractual obligation, and that's a finite number of people that receive that benefit, those members of Woodman. Now, those members are a well-defined, restricted group of individuals with a common characteristic, an insurance policy. The Nebraska Supreme Court has examined a similar group, the Nebraska State Bar Association, in determining if that was charitable, and determined that because the members of the Bar Association are a restricted group of persons with a common characteristic, a bar membership, that the benefit was not offered to an indefinite number of persons or the public. It was a limited group. So again, we have another issue with a 77202 analysis. Finally, that brings us to whether or not Woodman of the World is owned or used for financial gain or profit to either the owner or the user. In order to qualify for 77202 charity, they must not be. However, I pulled this screenshot from Woodman's 2013 annual report. And in the second paragraph, Woodman states, "We give back revenues to our members, not investors, in the form of refunds and benefits." And refunds and benefits directs you down to some notations at the bottom of the page, and it defines refunds. Refunds are declared annually by the company. The payment of refunds is not guaranteed because they depend on the company's investment, expense, and mortality experience. Now that sounds an awful lot like dividends. Now, we have not definitively determined whether this would could accurately be defined as dividends, but it's problematic enough that it was part of our analysis and our concern under 77202. Now, as I mentioned, we really hung our hats on 44-1095 and the exclusivity argument of 77-202. Thus, this is just a concerning area. It's also important to note from Woodman of the World's website that refunds paid to members, those funds that I just described that were similar to dividends, are expected to be approximately $66.5 million. Now, the other number that's been thrown around a lot is $40 million. So $40 million approximately is what's been donated to charities, but $66.5 million is the number of refunds that are being paid to members. So significantly higher than the number for charitable giving, and that lends to the exclusivity argument, that the primary purpose of Woodman is to sell insurance and to provide for their members, not the public or an indefinite number of persons. I've already discussed a little bit that charitable designations are not transferable, but I just want to point out that, again, in that Colorado Department of Revenue case, the Colorado Supreme Court recognized that. The Colorado Supreme Court said an organization may be deemed charitable by one statutory provision, but this designation is not transferable to another statutory provision. Before any organization is to be exempt from paying Colorado sales tax, it must satisfy in full the definition of charitable organization under their Sales Tax Act. So I would ask you today, when you hear that Woodman has been designated as charitable by other entities, to recognize that we need to narrow our focus and determine if it fits under 77202's definition. And I'll just quickly show you two screenshots from the IRS. If you look at an IRS 501c3 exemption, you'll see that the definition is much more similar to the 77202 definition than the 501c8 designation, which is what Woodman actually enjoys. So the 501c3 exemption has that exclusivity requirement, whereas the 501c8 designation relates to fraternal benefit societies. So again, although Woodman enjoys this nonprofit status under 501c8 and it might be informative, it's not controlling. It would be more informative if Woodman enjoyed the 501c3 status to our 77202 analysis. Now that we've discussed 44-1095 and 77202, One of the concerns that was raised by Woodman is Knights of Columbus, and whether or not Knights of Columbus should or should not be granted a property tax exemption. Now, Woodman of the World sent our office a letter which noted that several out counties have granted Knights of Columbus exemptions, as has our county. But as I mentioned, 44-1095 was not on our radar until this year. So I had to do a separate analysis for Knights of Columbus. And because our belief is that 44-1095 is the more specific statute that deals strictly with fraternal benefit societies, and Knights of Columbus is organized under those statutes, it's our opinion to the assessor and my belief that Mr. Morrissey's recommendation to the board is that Knights of Columbus also falls under the plain meaning of 44-1095 and would not qualify for a property tax exemption. Now, as I mentioned, Woodman is relying on several other counties in which Woodman has been granted an exemption. I specifically called the assessor of three of those counties, three of the, I believe it was five or six, three was all I was able to get a hold of, to determine their rationale. And just like our office, they were not aware of 44-1095. They were performing the analysis under 77-202, and were very interested to know what Douglas County, as the most populous county, was doing, and the rationale behind our analysis, and they want to be kept apprised of what this county board does. So I think it's accurate to say that it's not, it wouldn't be prudent to rely upon their designation or their analysis under 77-202, because like us, they weren't aware of 44-1095, and they're looking to see what we do. For these reasons, Woodman is not exempt under the plain language of 44-1095, and because 44-1095 deals solely with fraternal benefit societies, it's more specific than 77-202. Even if we did a 77-202 analysis, there are those problems I discussed: exclusivity, not being offered to the public or an indefinite number of persons, and the fact that its members receive money back in the form of refunds and benefits. As such, the Douglas County Attorney's Office has advised the Douglas County Assessor to respectfully recommend to this board to deny the Woodman of the World property exemption application. Thank you, and if you have any questions, I'll be happy to answer those.
Commissioner Boyle.
Yes, thank you, Ms. Dodson. That was an excellent presentation. Some questions, since this has been brought to the county board, have really been kind of circulating around in my mind about how we treat other nonprofit entities. I guess that's the best way to start to describe them. And specifically, when I start to supplant, put on names of corporations that I'm thinking about when you're speaking of Woodman, they seem to have the same flaw, if you will. And I'm speaking specifically of the Allegiant Hospital System, particularly the buildings they purchased from Blue Cross Blue Shield. And I don't know the valuation, if anyone does, but it evaporated once Blue Cross Blue Shield was gone and Allegiant stepped in. And secondly, even the operations of the hospital, when Creighton University Medical Center became nonprofit. You know, I don't expect them to not to pay their employees. I don't expect Allegiant not to pay their employees. So I'm wondering, what does nonprofit mean in all of this? I mean, they have to make a profit to pay employees. So what's permissible as a nonprofit and what's not? Do you know?
Yes. To an extent, it's defined differently, as I mentioned, by different entities. And the Nebraska Supreme Court has said that hospitals are exempt. They provide that that benefit, that last line in 77-202, that mental, social, or physical benefit to the public. And that's been the crux of that Nebraska Supreme Court analysis in determining that hospitals are exempt. And we cannot, as I mentioned, extend that exemption to insurance companies by construing the statutes. That has to either be done by legislature or the courts. And further, Woodman has noted that there are some administrative offices that have also been exempted that is concerning to them. And there is a case from the Nebraska Supreme Court, the Pioneer Village case, which states that if the entity is reasonably necessary to the larger entity, in this case the larger entity would be the hospital, that smaller entity may be exempt as well. So if you have an administrative office that's necessary to run a hospital, and that hospital is for the mental, social, or physical benefit of the public, then that may be exempt as well.
Well, I think, you know, you said something that rings a bell with me when I'm thinking of all of this, is that, and you said legislative. I think what's happening today could very well trigger a watershed decision that will put nonprofits, whatever they are, St. Cecilia's Cathedral included, on the tax rolls. I mean, I think we're on a very slippery slope. We had a case several years ago with two health centers. Everyone here who was here will remember it because it was a very close call, and I'm not sure we made the right decision. It was on a 4-3 vote, and it was for a cardiac care unit at, I believe, at Lakeside Hospital. They came in and asked for tax exemption. And the folks across the street or down by Prairie Life said, hey, wait a minute, we're doing the same thing. And so we heard the testimony, and Lakeside looked a lot like Prairie Life and vice versa. And the only difference was that they were for treating heart patients, but there were others who came too. Other people who had physical afflictions were getting treated there just as they were at Prairie Life down the road a piece. So this whole concept of nonprofit is one that obviously is open to a lot of interpretation, and whether or not individuals make salaries or they provide dividends really doesn't matter to me. I mean, I don't expect the people at Allegiant to be working for free either. And I think they're declaring dividends in one form or another, maybe not exactly that name. So, and I'm also interested too, if I could ask another question, about other fraternal organizations, the Eagles and the American Legion. What about those folks? Are they slated to get a county attorney's opinion to the county assessor that they should be on the tax rolls too, or have you thought that far?
Yes, I've anticipated that you may ask me that, and I think those are some legitimate concerns, and I'll address those concerns in turn. So your first concern was, I think it was regarding St. Cecilia's.
Yes.
And there is a specific provision in 77202 for religious organizations, and what the county attorney is saying is that we need not look at Woodman under 77202 because legislature has given us the exact guidelines under 44-1095 as to how to treat fraternals. So this decision wouldn't have any trickle-down effect, or it wouldn't be a slippery slope, because this only applies to fraternal benefit societies. Look to 44-1095. It's in the chapter on insurance. It only deals with those entities organized under those sections. So St. Cecilia's would not be potentially affected from this opinion.
How about the Scottish Rite Temple?
Now, the Scottish Rite Temple, if they were organized and licensed under sections 44-1072 to 44-1109, then it would be our interpretation that legislature intended them to be exempt from virtually all taxes other than taxes on real estate. Now, if legislature ultimately determined that they wanted us to look outside of 44-1095, that's something that they could do. But this 44-1095, a version of this has been on the books since the 1930s, and it's clear that fraternals should pay real estate taxes, very limited taxes. You know, they're exempt from several categories except taxes on real estate and office equipment.
Well, when I mentioned the slippery slope, I mean, the assessor's office will do these things, and they'll come in and make some changes and start charging property. There's a, I believe, the Pella Lutheran Church at 41st and Farnham had a Lenten program where they served lunch in their basement. And I believe the assessor's office removed the basement from tax exemption, and they had to pay taxes on the basement. So, I mean, this happens where there will be consequences from this. There is a slippery slope that we're beginning to slide down, and there will be profound changes, I think, probably regardless of how this issue winds up.
With respect to that church, I'm not familiar with the analysis and what happened there, but I know that you were addressing the dividend argument, and I just want to reassure you that that was not the crux of our analysis. That was just a minor concern, and frankly, the screenshot that I saw from the Woodmen of the World was something that we discovered yesterday. The crux of our analysis for months has been 44-1095, not the payment of potentially pseudo dividends. So I firmly believe that a 44-1095 denial should not have any effect on a religious organization.
Well, I mentioned the religious organization because we see so many with tax exempt plates, and they kind of stretch the limits. And I chose Cathedral because that's a parish that I know very well, and I just kind of want to give them their time.
Sure.
Make them kind of go, what'd he say? I also am concerned, frankly, too, about nonprofits, people making money, making a living, providing services. You know, we don't expect Mike Sacklar, the head of Sienna Francis House, who's doing a terrific job caring for the homeless, feeding thousands of people, and all the others that do in town, too. We don't expect him to be a hermit and not be able to have a salary. And so just like Mr. Sacklar, who's doing that very obvious kind of work, something that's not so obvious, the Woodman, because their individuals are being paid salaries, doesn't make them some kind of ogre. This is part of supporting the nonprofit work that they do. So I just like to get that out there, because I've heard comments about, doesn't look like a nonprofit to me. Well, neither does Allegiant.
And I agree, and we cited in our memo to the assessor that Woodman's charitable endeavors, we believe, are commendable. But the difference between a religious entity is it would be a very different analysis, because 44-1095 would not apply. And what we're saying is you can stop the analysis at 44-1095. Legislature has told us how to treat fraternal benefit societies, and we can stop there. We need not go to the other analysis. And that's why I believe it wouldn't trickle down.
Thank you, Ms. Dodson.
Thank you. Are there any other questions?
No other questions at this time. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Commissioner Rogers, sorry.
Explain to me how a law goes from good to bad.
Thank you. That's a good question. So a law may be overturned by a subsequent court. So maybe if the Nebraska Supreme Court had determined that fraternals in the early 1900s were not charitable, but later determined that they were charitable, that would be overruling the earlier decision. And so in this case, what Woodman is saying is, we had this decision from the Nebraska Supreme Court in 19, I believe it was 08. In the 1930s, legislature put a statute on the books that said Woodman is charitable. So that conflicts with the case from the early 1900s. However, what I'm saying is legislature defined Woodman as charitable within the confines of Chapter 44, whereas the Nebraska Supreme Court was examining charitable within the confines of Chapter 77. And the definition of charitable is not transferable from one section to another section. So the legislature enacting and labeling Woodman charitable for the purpose of the taxation statute doesn't overrule the Nebraska Supreme Court saying they're not charitable under the definition of 77.
And I'm trying to, I got it, but I just want to make it digestible in my own mind, so you can't double dip on a tax law.
You can't double dip, excuse me?
You're basically saying you can't double dip in tax law. If there's one law specifically to you, you can't have that and another one if one specific is to you.
Well, it would be problematic if the two laws directly conflicted, and we would have to look to rules of statutory construction. But that's not exactly what's happening here, because even though we have this definition from 44-1095, we reach the same result if we do an analysis under the other chapter as well.
Okay. Thanks.
Any other questions?
Not at this time.
Thank you for your time.
Thank you.
Anyone from Wood?
Yes.
Okay. Well, good morning.
Good morning.
For the record, I'm Matt Ellis. I'm the Vice President and General Counsel for Woodman of the World. I see Mr. Capito is not here, but we did provide him some information that we would like placed into the record. You know, we listened with great interest to Ms. Dobson, and I think I had mentioned on March 25th that based on the money at stake, we are expecting, you know, a more thorough legal review. My opinion remains the same, and the reason I say that is because Ms. Dobson's legal opinion was predicated on a case in Denver. And had she, and this is unfortunate and embarrassing, but had she read the case, she would have realized that's an entirely separate company. That is not us, Woodman of the World. That is another Woodman of the World in Colorado. And had she done a little bit more research, she would have found that we're actually suing that Woodman for trademark infringement across the street in federal court. So again, I struggle with, we're having a very important decision to make here, and what kind of legal analysis is being done. So I'll leave that as my opening mark, and it will go from there. I first want to talk about tax law, and as you know, that's a very complicated area. And I thought you might like to hear from an independent tax expert on this issue, and needless to say, his opinions will differ greatly from the county's opinion. So I have with me today Creighton Professor Ed Morse. He is one of, if not the, preeminent tax experts in Nebraska. Professor Morris holds the McGrath-North Endowed Chair in Business Law. He received his bachelor's degree from Drake and his Juris Doctorate degree from the University of Michigan Law School. His main academic focus is on business law and taxation. He has also teamed up with Professor Ernie Goss, which I think you know very well, on multiple projects. And he has facilitated many annual tax programs for the Great Plains Tax Institute. His comments have appeared in The Economist, NPR Marketplace, and other respectable media outlets. So I will turn it over to Professor Morris. Thanks.
Thank you. Good morning.
Good morning.
Thank you very much, Matt, and thank you, commissioners, for the privilege of speaking before you today. As Matt pointed out, Woodman has asked me to take a look at the statutory environment here and to provide an analysis of that environment, and I have endeavored to do that in the form of a very extensive written report, which I believe you have in the materials that are provided to you. Now, I must apologize at the outset for the length of that. It's about 13 pages of text and many pages of appendix. In part, that's just a genetic flaw because I'm an academic and I like to be thorough. But if I can take any refuge, it would be in Mark Twain's comment to his editor, who he told one time, if you would have given me a little more time, I could have written a shorter book. So, in any event, I assure you that I'll try to make my remarks more concise today, and I definitely want to just hit the highlights from that report as you're certainly able to read it. There's also an executive summary of that report provided. But the gist of the matter of statutory interpretation really gets at three principal areas, and particularly so in this case. We want to talk about the text, and that means what did the legislature say, and equally important, what did it not say. We also want to look at the context, meaning we don't want to look at the text in isolation. We want to look at it in relation to the whole statement of what was said. And also, in this case, it is very important because there are two statutes involved that both touch on the matter of taxation. In those circumstances, the preeminent rule for statutory construction, above all others, is that you ought to read those two provisions together, not in isolation from each other. And in doing so, what we're trying to do is make sure that we give due respect to everything the legislature said and didn't say in order to effectuate their intention. Now, in addition to the textual references, we can also look to legislative history for additional guidance. To the extent that our reading of the text leaves us with any doubt, we can get further assurance or guidance from the legislative history. And I'm going to do all three of those things for you today. And I think you're going to, I hope, reach the same conclusion I did, that woodmen should be entitled to an exemption under Section 77-202. And contrary to the reading of the county attorney, Section 44-1095 is not throwing a monkey wrench into that analysis. I was rather surprised to hear that this is was surprised to hear that this was the first time that that statute had come up for the county. But in another level, it's not surprising. But let me start with the text of that language. First of all, what does this statute say? What does 44-1095 say? It essentially does two things. It confers a charitable status on fraternal benefit societies. And then based on that status, it provides an exemption from taxation. The exemption is general and broad, but it is not unlimited. Because from that exemption, there is carved out the category of taxes on real estate and office equipment. That is what the statute says. Now, let us see what it does not say. The statute does not impose a tax on anyone. Nothing in that statute or in Chapter 44 imposes a tax on fraternal benefit associations. The statute also does not preclude an exemption. It simply says this general status-based exemption is limited in that it does not extend to real estate and office equipment. It does not say there shall not be an exemption for real estate and office equipment. The statute is silent on both of those topics. Where do we turn to resolve the silence? We look to where the legislature has also spoken on these topics. 77-201, that's the locus of the taxing power. And Section 77-202, which you're thoroughly familiar with in your role as a Board of Equalization, is where we speak to the topic of exemption. So, by reading these two statutes together, I think we come to a reasonable construction of both of them that leads us to the conclusion that 77-202 is the place to look when we're trying to ascertain whether an exemption is permitted. And that gives due respect and attention to all the language in those statutes. The county's position, on the other hand, does not do this. First, it would read in language in Section 44-1095 that is simply not there. It wants to make Section 44-1095 the exclusive taxing statute for fraternals. And with all due respect, that's not what the legislature said. It said they were charitable and it conferred an exemption. Conferring a limited exemption is not the same as imposing a tax. They would also say that that provision tells us we cannot provide an exemption, but it says no such thing. If you take the same approach that the county does in this case, what you effectively do is nullify Section 77-202 by writing it out of the law entirely when it comes to fraternals, or state it a little differently. You have to read in a new exception that would deny the same treatment to fraternals that would be allowed to other charitable organizations. And I submit to you, that is simply not what the legislature said in this case. Now, let's move on to this question of legislative history. My analysis contains quite an my document that I provided to you contains quite an extensive analysis of the legislative history, and there are many points that could be made here today. Let me focus on the main one. In LB 508, which enacted the current provision of 44-1095, there was extensive discussion in both committee reports and on the floor in the committee report from the Banking and Commerce Committee, by the way, not the Revenue Committee, and on the floor of the legislature, that discussed the whole purpose of granting a tax exemption toward fraternal benefit societies. And I think that larger context has instruction for us not only on this issue about how fraternals ought to be treated, but it may also be instructive as to how we treat tax exemptions generally. There was extensive testimony from the Senator Beyer, who was the sponsor of the bill, as well as from the then president of Woodman, about what fraternals did and the good that they do in society. In other words, the legislature looked at fraternals and recognized that they are contributing something to the social fabric. They are building social capital in a manner that the government could not do. They are doing this toward private, charitable actions, actions that come from free will, the goodness of the human heart, that are directed toward the well-being of others. That is an indispensable quality that we have long recognized in this country. Alexis de Tocqueville, when he came to America and wrote his famous book, Democracy in America, noted that you folks, you Americans, are constantly forming private organizations to solve your problems instead of relying on government. And as important as government might be to do certain things, there are some things it cannot do. When we start providing benefits to people from government, what happens? They become rights. The employees who are providing those benefits are doing it because it's their job. We know that that's not intuitively, I think we all know, that's not the same as providing something voluntarily and receiving a benefit, or inducing people to behave together in a collective way for the good of others, which fraternal benefit associations do very well. And in fact, you can say that the model being adopted for the fraternal benefit society is much the same as the model of a nonprofit or charitable hospital. And Commissioner Boyle, your questions about nonprofit are interesting because the word nonprofit actually doesn't appear, but it lurks in the background. The word in there is charitable. What we're saying is, for a special organization like a fraternal, the provision of insurance products and other forms of benefits become part of the vehicle for its ability to carry out a philanthropic, a charitable mission by the good works that it does throughout society. In the same way, the care that insured patients and paying patients receive at charitable hospitals also facilitate that charitable activity that can come through those forms of care. And we're simply providing those charitable benefits and those good works through the vehicle of the Fraternal Benefit Society. The legislature specifically considered arguments about the wisdom of doing just that. It said these societies have grown a lot since their early days. Their economic profile has grown. Those arguments about competition with for-profit entities were also taken seriously in the legislature, but ultimately they soundly rejected them. Why? It's because what Senator Beyer observed was true. These organizations are doing something that government cannot do. And in this sense, it's not that by giving them a tax exemption, we're not allowing them to skate on an obligation that they may have. Instead, we're simply saying, you're going to fulfill those obligations those public commitments through another means. That's through the charitable activities of the enterprise. Now, that's the history. That's the legislative history. Let's see how that plays into Section 77-202. I'm not going to provide the full analysis of that area because I think Mr. Ellis did a very careful analysis of 77-202 during your last meeting here. And I was privileged to be able to watch that, and I thought he did a very thorough job. But let's speak to this issue of once again, in response to what Ms. Dodson very carefully presented, let's perhaps inject some additional thoughts that might need to be considered. First of all, with regard to the matter of that Colorado case, she wants to invoke a principle that says the specific controls over the general. But the Colorado case was dealing with the first part of the equivalent to Section 44-1095, dealing with the tax exemption. So that's a completely different context. We say Section 44-1095 is silent on the matter of whether an exemption can be granted, and that Section 77-202 speaks to that issue. The Colorado case involving sales taxation is dealing with the opposite situation. It's dealing with the first part of this, the specific exemption in Section 44-1095 from just that sort of tax versus a more general provision or another specific provision in the revenue provisions, revenue statutes. So we have a very different factual context. Frankly, those two cases, that case and our case, are quite different in that we're saying 77-202 is where the legislature spoke, and the legislature saith not in Section 44-1095. So I think that's quite a different case. I would also like to mention this idea of presuming legislative knowledge should also be taken into account in reading and understanding the statutes here. LB 508 enacted Section 44-1095, but as Ms. Dodson correctly points out, that law has been on the books for a long time. It's been on the books from at least 1931, and very similar language granting this broad tax exemption. In 1984, right before the legislature essentially reenacted this provision, granting an exemption for fraternals, the legislature also considered the issue of property tax exemptions, and it gave us the language that we have today in 77-202-1D that's the subject of the controversy today. Now, if you take those actions in context, and we presume the legislature knew how to act in these cases and knew what it said, it's not surprising at all that the legislature would say nothing in Section 44-1095. Why? We're continuing the law that existed before that time. Also, it's not surprising that the legislature would say nothing special in Section 77-202 that would exempt or preclude fraternals from seeking a charitable tax exemption in the same manner as any other charitable entity. If you look carefully at the language of Section 77-202, you can see that indeed charitable activities are being carried out by fraternals. They are designated as charitable organizations in Section 44-1095, but they also serve the principles in Section 77-202-D1, in that is the raison d'etre, that is the reason of their existence, is to provide these benefits. Now, much has been made about the fact that fraternals return some of the premium dollars that they receive and some of the benefits in the form of a refund to their members. However, I would submit to you That's part of what makes a fraternal benefit association, which is required by law to provide insurance benefits as part of its existence. That's part of the engine that drives its ability to do those charitable activities. So I think, again, all these things need to be taken into account. The context, as well as the text, what the legislature said, what the legislature did not say, in trying to make sense of this area. And I hope that you will agree with me that this presents a very persuasive, indeed compelling case for granting an exemption to Woodman in the same manner that other charitable organizations have been granted exemptions for years under the same statute. Thank you very much. That concludes my remarks. I'm more than happy to take questions or to simply allow you to digest the written materials that I've given you.
And this is going to take quite a bit of digestion. You know, sometimes silence speaks volumes. And you're talking about the silence about and about imposing taxation. I believe, because I don't know at this point until I read everything, but perhaps the silence is giving us the option of taxing or not taxing. This is an extremely mind-boggling case, and I'm hoping we don't make a decision today so I can read your however many pages of footnotes and documentations,
all right,
along with your 13 pages of analysis.
But may I speak to that?
Yes.
Issue? May I answer that?
Please do.
I think there are undoubtedly political pressures that you would sense in your position as a custodian of the public trust as well. But the guidance is indeed, you're not left without guidance. The guidance is found in section 77-202D1. That's the intention of the legislature that's being expressed here, as well as that general intention that was left when LB 508 was enacted. So I don't think that there is room for pure discretion. I think that the standards in section 77-202D1 have to be followed and should be followed consistently, and that's for the benefit, that's part of our constitutional structure. So that means that equal cases get treated equally. We treat similar cases in a like way. That kind of transparency is an important part of the rule of law, and it's an important part of our constitutional system.
Okay. Which was written first, 77-201 or 44-1095?
Well, 201 is the taxing statute.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I believe it was written in advance of 44-1095, although I'd have to confirm.
Should not that chronology also come into play?
Well, I tried to address the chronology in my materials on legislative history, and here's how we do it. Because Ms. Dodson correctly points out, you presume that the legislature knows what it's already written, right?
Not a safe assumption.
Well, I know. But the law presumes it, right? Because if we are to do otherwise, then we presume irrationality, which makes a system of law based on reason impossible, right? So if we presume that and we start from that position, we'd have to say that when the legislature was making its amendments in section 77-202 in 1984, and by the way, the history of those amendments are in one of the cases brought out by Ms. Dodson. It's the Nebraska Bar Foundation case. Now, part of the rationale of that case is, hey, you're benefiting lawyers. I happen to be one. I hold a law license in Nebraska. It's quite different to say that a class that requires you to study undergraduate, go to law school, pass the bar in order to get a ticket for admission is a quite different category of persons than is faced by the fraternal. So I think that's quite different. But back in 1944, or 1984, when that language was being crafted, the legislature should be presumed to know that the fraternals are out there, right? And they also know that they didn't speak to the issue of exemptions. So what are we to presume by looking at 77-202? They didn't write it in a way to say fraternals are not eligible. They wrote it in a broad and inclusive way. So in that, from that perspective, you have to say that what we're doing or what you're doing here is interpreting a specific law of exemption. You're not trying to expand it by construction. You're simply applying the law as written to say, hey, is Woodman, as a fraternal benefit society, a charitable organization? Yes, it meets the definitions provided there too. And it would meet it in the same manner and by the same purpose and rationale as we do those exemptions for charitable hospitals.
And you feel it meets that exclusivity rule?
Well, as that rule has been interpreted and applied, because therein lies a potential problem, and I'm going to leave that to Mr. Ellis because I know he's studied that issue at greater length. But as interpreted and applied, I think Mr. Boyle raises a very interesting concept there.
I just started reading a very interesting book called The Pig That Wants to Be Eaten. And chapter 3 deals with this issue, and it is caused for philosophical thinking. Okay. I could argue either side of your argument, as I have a feeling you could also. Using the assumption that legislators know what they're doing, okay, and know what's in the law, they would be using that assumption to say we need to carve this piece out because it's not covered, and therefore we will do the interpretation that Woodmen of the World should be paying taxes, or fraternal orders, excuse me, should be paying taxes on their real estate. So yeah, it's as I said, it's mind-boggling the quandary we have here. And as I'll reiterate, I hope we don't make a decision today because I want to read every word of this again. Thank you.
Thank you.
Commissioner Rogers?
Okay, I wasn't here for the first meeting, and you know, even though I like to think I want to be a lawyer, I'm not about to challenge you. But not being here, there's two things that stand out from what you're saying. And not having read it, you know, it's just little common sense that I'm trying to gauge on this. And this is what I hear when you make your case. There is a part of me when it says, let words mean what they mean. When you make your case, I hear me talking to my son the other night and saying, do you got any homework? He said, no, I don't have any homework. I said, then he comes up at night, and I said, did you do your envision? And he said, no, I didn't. I said, I just asked you, did you have homework? And then he said, well, that's not homework. I said, your teacher gave you that to come home to do every night.
Mm-hmm.
So when I hear you say, no, it doesn't say it's taxes, yeah, it doesn't say it. But when I ask you, do you got homework, you know what I mean.
Yeah.
And the language says that.
Yeah.
That's number one.
Okay.
Number two, I have an issue understanding what's different the case you make from public good, because when the definition I hear of public good, it is, you know, you're comparing the government saying the government can't exactly, you know, do everything, which I think most people agree. Mm-hmm. But when we define public good for eminent domain, we talk about, you know, infrastructure, sidewalks, thing everybody use.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I'm familiar. I haven't read Woodman's annual report in a while, but I know they do a lot of summer youth programs and stuff like that. That's not, you know, on the massive scale of a government. And it sounds to me no different than a point of saying a for-profit company, that the only difference how you classify is that you can say that UPs, the big companies, give a certain amount of their money to certain things, and the only thing that they're allowed to do is write it off. Other than the classification that you're in, that's what I hear. I mean, that's what I hear. Without having to read all this, those are two things that I pulled up.
Okay.
And so I have a hard issue when you're saying let words be words. Yes, it was silent, but it clearly tells you what's going to do. And when you talk about this case brought in 84, with the cadre of lawyers that are here, It's hard for me to believe that 20 years would go by and this would just be coming up if there was even an opportunity for it to be written off.
May I respond?
Mm-hmm.
Well, let me respond in a couple ways. First, I think...
Can you speak to the mic, please?
Let me respond. I'm used to walking around my
right.
class. No, okay. Mr. Rogers, thank you for that. Let me respond in a couple ways. First of all, let words be words is important. But remember, when there's doubt, we can go to the legislative history. One of the things you see in the legislative history is when Senator Byers introduces this legislation, where does it go? It gets referred to the Committee on Banking, Commerce, and Insurance. It's not referred to the Revenues Committee, right? Why? Because the purpose of the bill, it does contain an exemption for the fraternals, but the purpose of the bill, by and large, was to regulate their offerings of insurance that were consistent with that exemption, that, you know, again, underlies it. You see, time and time again, in the legislative history, attempts by Senator Landis in two events to try to take away the tax, to limit that tax exemption, all right? First, he wants to amend Section 72-908 and -909, which then applied premium taxes to for-profit insurers, right? And the premium tax provisions in Chapter 77 contain specific exemptions to say, don't apply these to fraternals. The revenue, legislature ruled his amendment non-germane. In other words, this is not what we're talking about here. We're not talking about imposing taxes. That wasn't the purpose of it. They presuppose that this exempt status is going to continue, and the underlying purposes for it were clearly discussed in the legislative history. Now, with regard to for-profit firms, do they do good things too? Absolutely. Why? They view that as part of their social responsibility to do that, right? That is part of a movement of integrating corporate life into community life. But they're limited in their ability to do so. They cannot give away massive amounts of their profits to charitable activities. And if you ask them what their purpose is, it's to make money for their shareholders. And that's as it should be. Why? Every one of us in this room may reach retirement age someday, and we hope those retirement accounts that are invested in those stocks will generate those kinds of returns that we need so that when we're older and have time, we can invest our lives into our communities and we can afford to do so. So I think there's quite a distinction between those two types of event, of organizations and events. The charitable works that come from fraternals, they include those summer youth programs. They include those forms of investment. But those aren't done all by employees. Those are also done by members who are part of the organization, who then make a commitment to become engaged, to help one another, as well as to help the communities that they're in. And that kind of social capital is something that we're running low on. We do pretty well in this part of the world, but unfortunately, as government has grown, some of that private initiative and private ordering has shrunken. And I think that the legislature's intention in 1985 to reenact this exemption, as well as to enact a property tax exemption, keep in mind, those have been left untouched despite many opportunities to change them, many opportunities to retract or limit the scope of those benefits. Those have not been, the legislature has not chosen to do that. And I think that also should bear some weight in interpreting the laws with some consistency. The Knights of Columbus, Woodmen of the World, fraternals have long been treated in this category. Continuing that treatment makes a lot of sense.
Okay, two things then. You bring up legislative history. There's a bill that was passed, and this is where I get my reflection of legislative history. LB 800, and everybody here knows what LB 800 is. On the floor,
mm-hmm.
A senator said, we do not mean for any cost to get past the counties. That's part of the legislative record. That's part of the history. I'm seeing that in the same realm you did.
Mm-hmm.
But that didn't hinder them from not doing that.
Mm-hmm.
Because the law was silent on it, and they charged us, and we had no defense. So that's my reference right here for one. And then the point you made about the membership society, if a member, which you claim, does work for them, does Woodman, count that as service by the company since they're a member, or does that member have the ability to write that contribution off separately tax-wise as volunteerism that they do on their own?
I can only speak, I don't know what the, I think Mr. Ellis would be the better person to address the Woodman practice with that. I know that when I, from a matter of tax law, if I go and do a charitable act or charitable service, mm-hmm. I don't have a tax deduction from my service. It's a contributed labor. Part of it is I don't have any wealth that I generate. If I go earn income and then donate the money, then I have a tax deduction, but I don't have one simply from providing service.
Well, let me make it a little clear. I guess I don't know. You know, you're saying your members. When you think your members, I think of, you know, is counted toward Woodman's contribution to volunteerism. This is what I do know for sure. If that member does volunteerism, they can count the mileage that they do back and forth to that volunteerism and get that written off. Okay, that's what I guess mean specifically. So
I'm just saying,
this is a real argument, subtle argument. I'm not trying to compete on it, but like Commissioner Kraft said, it seems like it's kind of getting to that point. So if you're going to claim them as a member, can they write off on their own and you still claiming those guys as a member, or do you claim them as members as a part of a service that they do for you? And I'm just trying to get, you know, in my own knowledge, if you're saying they're a member and they're doing work somewhere else, if they're not claimed as a part of you, they're doing their own thing, and to me that argument doesn't seem solid.
Well, they get a mileage deduction, though, because they have an out-of-pocket cost in connection with operating the automobile, and with charitable mileage, you get only essentially a variable cost. You don't get the depreciation. So they have a separate cost. But beyond that, I would leave that to Mr. Ellis.
No, we don't double count. We don't double count, Commissioner. So
do you count them as volunteers for you when they do that?
When they do an organized effort that Woodman organizes, that does count as our volunteer hour. Now, if they have personal deductions that they can take because of that, that's great. But that is a volunteer hour that Woodman counts because we've organized it on their behalf, and we've probably provided matching funds for that event as well. So yes, but we don't.
Is that from what you give out of the was it 40% that you give away or the 60% that you keep?
Well, 40% that we give away. So we give away 40% that does all sorts of projects throughout the country. I think every school in around here has a flag and a flagpole, thanks to Woodman. And when our members show up to dedicate the flag and the flagpole, that's because Woodman has sponsored that event. Now, if they deduct, you know, I'm not an expert on personal taxes. If they deduct, you know, personal taxes for their mileage, you know, so be it. But we don't calculate that kind of stuff.
Okay.
The social capital is not something we calculate in terms of dollars. The $40 million is hard cash. So
okay.
Hopefully that answers your question.
No, it just feels like the social capital is what you're relying on.
I wouldn't agree with that at all. You're acting as if the $40 million can't be accounted for. We don't say, like, if Mr. Rogers, you go volunteer for an hour and your hourly rate's $500 an hour, we don't calculate that in the $40 million. So no, we're not putting a value on social capital. We're looking at cash out the door. So
like I said, I don't know what's gonna happen today. The only thing I know is that the basic maximum of it looks like a duck, it walks like a duck. It's a duck.
Well, can I address that for a second, though?
No, I'm going to go to a couple more questions,
okay.
And then we'll come back.
Thank you, Madam Chair.
Uh-huh. Commissioner Duda.
Thank you. As a farmer listening to a room full of lawyers, I appreciate plain speak, whether it's Commissioner Rogers' kid getting out doing homework, or Senator Beyer. I knew Senator Beyer. He used to haul cattle for us, and he was pretty plain speak. He was quite a down-to-earth person, and I could understand what he was saying and what he intended. My question has already sort of been asked before, but I come back to it. I knew your predecessor, of course, and you're following in very competent footsteps. I mean, Woodman has always had good counsel, I've believed. You've had good leadership. And seeing that Judge Bookout participated in the discussion down here in the legislature some almost 30 years ago, that we're now discussing.
Mm-hmm.
It's hard. I mean, we were told that new leadership at Woodman, new council, mm-hmm. is the time to review everything, and that's what prompted this move right now to say we really shouldn't mm-hmm. be tax exempt and should have been all along.
Mm-hmm.
if Judge Bookout participated in the conversation in the legislature almost 30 years ago, and we're now relying on the outcome of those votes, why did Woodman wait? I come back to this question again. Why did Woodman wait almost 30 years to say, see, we're supposed to be exempt? Mm-hmm. I'm missing something here.
Well, Mr. Duda, that's a very good question. I can't answer for Judge Bookout, and unfortunately, he's deceased, so I can't ask him. But, you know, with new leadership come new opinions. Why don't we ask the assessor's office, why did they not know about 44-1095 until today? You know, things happen. People learn new things. That doesn't prohibit their rights, though.
Indeed.
And so I'm not sure a legal case hinges on a change of opinion or a legal statute. And I think the issue goes, you know, two ways here, in that our lodge was exempt for 25 years and the assessor has changed his mind. So, you know, I can't, things change.
Okay.
But I think we qualify under the law, though. I can tell you that. That's where I answer that question.
Very good. Okay. Thank you.
Commissioner Boyle.
Yes. I'll just offer a little snapshot on other people who didn't do things and came back 30 years later. The city of Omaha has, under the Nebraska law, has very broad annexation authority. And when the city of Omaha annexes area, the Metropolitan Utilities District follows into the new boundary and actually takes over, confiscates existing utility systems. Under the law, they have to compensate the owner, but it's clear that MUD has the authority to take over the system, and it's in the interest of some continuity in the community. The Omaha Public School District had that same authority, and when the city of Millard was annexed, it was not a friendly annexation. Just ask Commissioner Borgeson. You know, I mean, she still refers to it as Millard. But there were some awfully hard feelings. There were police officers spat upon and a lot of bad deals. OPS got scared, and they decided not to annex the Millard Public School District or any of those other schools out there that were in the jurisdiction of the city of Millard. And then they set a tone, and they changed their operations so that they didn't annex anymore at all. And so now you find OPS confined with limited boundaries. It can't go anywhere. And that's what the cause was all about a couple of years ago, one city, one school district, was that it was trying to say, let's expand it so that we can enhance the education of everybody. That's what they should have done. And they got bad advice from somebody to back off the annexation. So things happen, and for very practical reasons. And I would compare that with, you know, I don't think we should look at Woodman and say, well, how come you're coming at us now? I mean, all we have to look at are things like the economy in the last couple of years, what's happened. I would assume that's affected their operations. I mean, I think it's a decision they've made in good faith, and they're invoking, I think, a statute that just may, if we decide, just may give them the relief they're requesting. So I don't have a problem, just like others who have made decisions not to take advantage of laws like OPS didn't do it. I don't hold them in any different light than they're just making a decision to do this now. And so it doesn't concern me. But one of the questions I wanted to get to was in Professor Morse's remarks about, in his attachment, the legislative history, which I really I always enjoy reading this to see what they're thinking. And on a personal note, I have to tell you that my wife's aunt is Senator Higgins, and she's in this too. But she didn't, for some reason, get into it too big. I don't know. She kind of gave Judge Bookout a couple of bad questions. But outside of that, I'm curious, Mr. Morris, can you tell us where in this legislative history do you think the silver bullet is that says, can give us any clarity on what they really intended? Is there any phrase that jumps out that says this is what we should do?
Mr. Boyle, I think I did try to reference that in my narrative, but I think the key language in my mind is comes from Mr. Duda's friend, Senator Beyer.
Uh-huh.
Because what he's saying is, and I think it comes later in the floor debates in response to Senator Landis's cry for let's level the playing field among the competitors. And he says, look, these people are doing things that government simply cannot do. And for that reason, we ought to preserve their exemption. And I think that's instructive in interpreting an exemption, a general exemption here. It's also instructive because the same kind of rationale underlies the reason to grant property tax exemptions. The idea is, instead of government taking funds, redistributing them for other socially beneficial purposes, we leave those funds in the hands of the charitable entity, and we allow the charitable entity to do good with them. We give them a non-specific direction. Go out and do good. Go out and change the world. And that reaps benefits for us as a society that cannot be duplicated in the other environment.
Thank you very much.
Commissioner Kraft.
Yes, Ms. Dobson, I hope I'm saying your name correctly.
It's Dobson, D-O-B-S-O-N.
D-O-B? Okay, mm-hmm. Thank you. Do you have anything you'd like to say as a rebuttal at this point?
A few things. Sort of going backwards and addressing most recently the legislative history. With regards to Senator Byer's comments and in regards to attempting to, or in rebuttal to leveling the playing field seeking to preserve an exemption, I agree that Senator Byer was seeking to preserve an exemption other than an exemption on real estate. That those words weren't at issue. What was at issue in a debate with Senator Landis was a separate potential tax that Senator Landis was debating about, and you'll see in that history. But there wasn't discussion about the words other than taxes on real estate and office equipment, not extensive discussion to my recollection. However, in response to Commissioner Rogers' statements, the Nebraska Supreme Court has told us very clearly that when you have a law that's plain and unambiguous on its face, you do not need to go to the legislative history. You determine the meaning of the legislators from the plain language. So in other words, we don't need to look at the legislative history of did you do your homework? It's plain. This is plain, and we need not look to the legislative history. A few other things, and that is firstly, I'll just say that with respect to the Woodman of the World case out of Colorado, we still rely on the analysis in that case. The analysis of this Colorado Supreme Court deals with fraternal benefit societies, and the analysis about exclusivity deals with fraternal benefit societies as insurance companies and not strictly with Woodman of the World. So there is a likelihood of confusion, hence the trademark case, when there are two cases, two entities named Woodman of the World, but it does not change our analysis. We're confident in our analysis, and frankly, the idea that we have not spent a sufficient amount of time or a reasonable amount of time on this is wishful thinking. Similarly, we were first made aware of that case, that Colorado case, from a letter that Woodman of the World actually provided us from the Nebraska Department of Revenue, where the Nebraska Department of Revenue also relied on that Colorado case. And it's important to note that in the letter from Woodman, Woodman says explicitly Endor does not agree with Douglas County. I spoke with Endor, Nebraska Department of Revenue, and they said they're not taking a position on this matter at all. So that's simply not true. So our analysis stands, and for the same reasons we stated earlier. Did those address your questions?
Yes.
No other lights are on We are coming to a good amount of time spent on this issue, and so at this point, I would ask what the will of the board is.
I'd like to lay this over at least a week.
Two weeks.
Yeah, we don't
so
meet.
That we have a chance to digest.
Is there a way we can continue to talk? I mean, we didn't get to finish our remarks. We were.
Yeah.
Yes, please.
It'll be brief.
Yes.
Okay, thank you. And I will be brief. You know, I just want to reiterate, there's constitutional rights, too, that we have to talk about. This is a legal case. This is not a matter of opinion. You know, we talked about 3 weeks ago that there was the personal opinion of the assessor's office that insurance isn't charitable. And that may be your personal opinions as well. But that is now the opinion of 44-1076, which is a statute which says to be the charitable and benevolent institution that we are, we have to sell insurance. So if the discussion is, should we be charitable for selling insurance, then we need to head to Lincoln and debate that on 44-1076. And we noticed that that was omitted from the county attorney's opinion entirely. I'm very, very concerned about when a taxpayer comes here and asks for a property tax exemption, and we open a dialogue with the assessor's office and the county attorney's office, and we invite them to call us, and let's have the discussion. And then we come here today, they put words in our mouth when it's not even our case. That's a major oops. This is a lot of money, and the legal analysis needs to be on point, and it needs to be inclusive of things that have been omitted. The 44-1076 cannot go without being noticed and analyzed. It makes the same difference between not-for-profit hospitals and for-profit hospitals in the insurance industry. There are not-for-profit insurance companies and for-profit insurance companies. And just as Allegiant bought 7261 Mercy Road and has an HR department, we have an HR department across the street. Just as they have a finance department, we have a finance department across the street. Just as they have quality assurance, we have quality assurance across the street. Those are analogous. And if you're going to say and have a standard in Douglas County that the administrative offices can't be separated from the charity, we say we agree with you. You can't hold us to a standard that does not exist with other folks that are very similar. And the last thing I'll say is I was surprised that they didn't bring up until someone asked about the Pioneer Village case. Because if the Supreme Court were in here today, I think they would laugh a little bit. Because we're debating whether or not insurance is charitable or not charitable, and all the hurdle we have to overcome is reasonably necessary. Is our insurance operation reasonably necessary for the charitable operation? If so, your property can be property tax exempt. And I don't know how anyone can get past the fact there's a statute that says we have to sell insurance. So if a statute says we have to sell insurance, how is that not reasonably necessary to finish with the charity? Okay. So again, I appreciate the dialogue, but I'm very concerned about our constitutional rights in that we're getting legal opinions that are in fact, well, disappointing. That's the best word I can use. Thank you. Larry, did you want to say anything real quick? Or?
Commissioner Rogers.
I just want to, because we're going to wait a week, but I just want to be clear from what you just said that I don't understand, and I'm sorry if I'm going to use a sports analogy.
Mm-hmm.
You know, every time you talk about this, you leave out 1095.
Mm-hmm.
And when I just use a sports analogy, in the NBA, when a person takes a charge, it's a charge.
Right.
But they wrote a specific rule that says if you're inside this circle that's by the basket, that's not to count.
Right.
And I'm just trying to simplify this.
Mm-hmm.
When you talk about something else, but you don't talk about the specific rule that's to you. And so I don't know what we're going to do for 2 weeks, but I'm just telling you, I know this is an argument. You're framing it how you're going to, but I just want to hear you why the point that's written specifically for you. You keep mentioning this one, but you don't mention how this plays.
Well, Commissioner, I appreciate the question. With all due respect, I think tax law is a little bit more complicated than basketball charge, but
and that's why I'm telling you that's where I'm at. 2 weeks to make me come
Right. So, 44-1095 is a statute that's in the insurance code. And if that is a revenue statute, then how should we be taxed? And you go to 44-1095, it doesn't say anything of how we should be taxed. So then you go to 77, which is the revenue statute, and it tells you how you're to be taxed, and oh, and lo and behold, when you get there, there's a provision that allows you to be exempt. So you can't tell a taxpayer that part of a revenue statute applies to you, but part of it doesn't. It does not exempt us under 77-202.
Well, you just said 1095 doesn't tell you how you're supposed to be taxed?
It doesn't tell me how it's supposed to be taxed.
Yes, it does. It said other than taxes and real estate.
It does not tell us. Great. So how is our real estate supposed to be taxed?
Well,
you go to the revenue statute to figure that out.
Yeah, okay. We can't get to that here, but which goes back to the plain meaning of the language.
That's why it's a little more complicated than basketball, but I appreciate what you're saying.
No, it is. But I'm just saying, I'm making my point of where you prove your case. You just said it doesn't say that, but it does say other than real estate. So when you fall back onto the plain meaning of the language,
mm-hmm.
I'm just telling you.
I appreciate your comment. We'll respectfully disagree, though.
Okay. Yeah. You got 2 weeks.
Yeah. Well, yeah. All right.
Thank you. There's no other lights. There was a motion and a second, right, to lay over, or did we still need a second?
Correct, Madam Chair.
Okay, please vote.
Motion passes.
Madam Chair.
Yes, Mr. Boyle.
I'd like to ask all the parties if there will be new information presented, that it be sent somewhat in advance of the meeting to give us a chance to digest it, maybe ask some questions. On a personal note, I really want to thank all the parties involved, including myself, for behaving today. So we appreciate very much what Women of the World does, and we take this issue very seriously. So we appreciate your presentations, and very, very adequate, to say the least. Thank you, especially to Professor Morris.
With that, we will adjourn, a motion to adjourn, and go back into the Board of Commissioners. Please vote.
Motion passes.
We are now back into the agenda for the Douglas County Board of Commissioners and the minutes and claims. Item 1, approval of minutes of Board of Commissioners meeting held Tuesday, April 8th, 2014. Item B, approval of claims submitted for payment process through Tuesday, April 22nd, 2014.
Second.
Any questions or comments? Please vote.
Motion passes.
The consent agenda is next. Items A through K minus I.
Motion approved.
Any questions or comments? Please vote.
Just a moment, please. Okay. Motion passes, so noted.
Go ahead, Commissioner Martin.
I abstain from that because Bob Lampier is an employee of mine.
So that was my reason for abstaining on that appointment.
Okay. Recognition and proclamations. We have the ones we've already taken up ahead of time on recognizing the county employees. We do have a resolution of sympathy for the family of Vivian Chamont. And some of you may not have known Vivian, but so I would like to read this resolution into the record. Whereas it was with great sadness that the Douglas County Board of Commissioners learned of the death of Vivian Chamont, Director of Nebraska's Health and Human Services, Medicaid and Long-Term Care Division, on April 10th, 2014, at the age of 60. And whereas Ms. Chamont is survived by her three children, Jonathan, Colin, and Katie. And whereas Ms. Chamont was born in Cuba and received her bachelor's and law degree from the University of California, Davis. And whereas May 2007, Ms. Chamont was appointed by Governor Heinemann to serve as the director of the HHS Finance and Support Agency and subsequently transitioned to director of the Medicaid and Long-Term Care Division July of 2007, encompassing the Medicaid program, home and community service program, and the state unit on aging. And whereas for the greater part of her career, Ms. Tremont was a dedicated public servant, serving in various roles as counsel to Medicaid and other health-related programs within California, Colorado, and Nebraska. And whereas this board recognizes that her passing has caused great sadness to her families and friends. Now, therefore, be it resolved by this Board of County Commissioners, Douglas County, Nebraska, that this board hereby commemorates the public service contributions of Vivian Tremont to her community and to the residents of Nebraska, and does hereby extend the board's sincerest sympathies to her families and friends, dated this 15th of April, 2014.
Motion to approve.
Second.
And I worked for a long time with Vivian on Medicaid issues and the long-term care. And while some may think of her as being stubborn and hard-nosed on issues, she was always one that you could call up and she would be on the phone or invite you to the table to discuss an issue in length and in depth. And I grew to appreciate that because, as we all know, they're very complicated issues. But she was very inviting and very thorough and professional always in her dealings that had to do with county and aging and Medicaid. So she will well be remembered for that. Please vote.
Motion passes.
And can we just make sure that a nice hard copy with a frame is sent to the chair panel? Citizen comments. Is there anyone in the chamber wishing to speak to the board about an issue not on the agenda? Hi, Melanie.
Good morning, commissioners. I wasn't sure if it was still morning. My name is, excuse me, Melanie Williams Smotherman. I live at 16022 Orchard Circle. For the benefit of those who might not know, I am, sorry, I'm also the founder of the Family Advocacy Movement. I first wanted to applaud a couple of positive developments since I last was here visiting, and one is the change in the truancy law. I applaud this board for an active role in helping to bring attention to the importance of changes to that law, and I think that we'll see a lot of positive benefits from that. Also, I wanted to report that the last I was here speaking, I spoke about a young man who was locked up in the DCYC, and he's currently now home with his grandmother. The case is still going on. There, you know, everyone's on pins and needles as far as moving forward in hoping that he gets to remain at home. But a lot of positive developments have occurred with that, and I'll keep you all apprised on how that goes. I wanted to let you know a little bit about why I'm here today with regard to my involvement as a stakeholder in child welfare and juvenile justice. I have, since founding the Family Advocacy Movement 5 years ago, I have testified countless times in front of the Nebraska legislature on issues having to do with child welfare and juvenile justice and other public bodies. I have written extensively and been a part of research projects with regard to child welfare and juvenile justice, and I've advocated for families over the last 5 years, donating my time and resources to helping those who tend not to have much of a voice in these systems that you know, I often refer to as industries. And sometimes these industries are a well-oiled machine that don't really allow much for individualized attention to situations, and that's my role as an advocate, to help provide more opportunity for children and families to have that voice in those systems. And it's sometimes done without a lot of appreciation by system officials, and I understand that. But I still will continue to fight for that room, because I think it's very important that there is more transparency, that there is more of a challenge to the status quo operations that I think we all are a part of recognizing as best practices continue to help us learn that there need to be reforms made to make the systems better and more healthy and responsive to the needs of citizens. And because of that, I wanted to let you know that I shouldn't have to really explain much more than that to help people understand why I am a stakeholder in these issues and why I am concerned, therefore, that my participation in observing and participating, if I so choose, in the process of the Juvenile Detention Alternatives Initiative is, you know, something that should be expected. But it appears as though the leadership for the Juvenile Detention Alternatives Initiative isn't that receptive, welcoming, or I guess willing to allow public observation in the collaborative meetings, and I'm not sure why. I'm not sure how to get the answer for why this is happening. I know that this initiative is an attempt to reform a system that is recognizably in need of serious reforms. And part of my talk last month involved the experience of this young man in the DCYC. I questioned that he, you know, likely should never have even been there at age 11 with the reasons that were stated for him being there. But I was also reflective of how children are treated in those systems still 4 years after the JDAI has come into being in our own state, being led to court in shackles. You know, children as young as 8, I was told. It doesn't matter how old a child is. Why is it that we as citizens and stakeholders can't bring these questions more to the forefront and challenge why there isn't better movement in reforming these systems? And why is it that the vehicle for which to do this, which is the JDAI Collaborative, why is it that they are successfully preventing the public and stakeholders like myself from being a part of even observing their processes? I think that, you know, whenever there appear to be super secret meetings that I challenge should be public meetings, they're listed on the website as taking place. They don't say that they're secret. They don't say that they're private and closed. But I wasted my gas last Tuesday parking, attending that meeting just to be booted out. Now, Judge Daniels and Thomas Warren are in charge of that collaborative. They weren't there at the time. Shaquille Malik was the person who approached me and essentially told me I couldn't stay to observe. I wasn't given a proper reason other than, well, this is just a work group. My request was, knowing public meetings laws, my request was to learn, first of all, whether or not there's a quorum. I don't even know who's on the collaborative. I don't know what the roster is. I don't know, you know, what kind of decisions or information is being shared there, which was my reason for wanting to be there. But I wasn't given an appropriate or adequate reason to my, you know, as far as I believe, for why it was so important for me to be ejected from even observing. I know that there was a woman there from the Sherwood Foundation, but she wasn't ejected, and she's a she's not a part of the collaborative. So there are these questions, and then further, we're still having trouble getting public records. You know, I don't think that general information that should be available to the public should be withheld, or that barriers should be put up in the way. We're not just trying to cause trouble for the county or city government. We are trying in earnest to be a part of a process that I think that the public really needs to be a part of. So those are my comments.
Thank you, Melanie. We are actually looking at those meetings, and all the JDAI meetings we feel should be open. There's really no confidential information that is presented or given that would warrant any of the meetings to be closed, so we are looking at that once it was brought to our attention.
I appreciate that very much.
Okay.
Thank you.
Hi, Laura.
Hi. Laura McCormick, 7414 Valley. Actually, the meeting that Melanie attended, I was able to go to a prior one, maybe 2 months back. I really can't explain why I was allowed to stay. I can tell you that this is the data committee where they are discussing the 60% override rate that we have for low-risk offenders. These are youth that should never have been sent to the DCYC. National instruments would tell you that we should have about a 15% override rate, and we do not. We're years into this initiative. I took out my iPad and began recording the meeting, the data meeting, which was not received well, although I was not asked to leave. I was told that I had to attend a court hearing, and so Melanie went. Yes, we should talk some, I suppose, about that. But in any event, I was at court, and so Melanie went to the meeting, and I was unsurprised that she was ejected. I've been told that I cannot attend the meetings. My questions are not popular. My questions center around how it can be. For the citizens listening, please come to the collaborative and watch 20 city, county, state-paid individuals talk about things for years on end and really not accomplish much in the way. I'm sorry, not to offend you all, but I have higher expectations, particularly when the subject matter of JDAI is youth. As Melanie spoke about, we together are very much involved in a young boy's case that is very representative of this problem. He was sent to the DCYC. He should never have been sent there. I was at a family team meeting with, again, 20 people who all received paychecks from either the state, NFC, the state's vendor, probation, the GAL was there. I was the only person there not receiving a paycheck, and I was the only person who, as in flipping through the packet of materials, said, wait a minute, time out, why is this kid in the DCYC? His rating on this instrument, the risk assessment instrument provided by Annie E. Casey, is a 6, and I would argue it should have been a 5, which means 0 to 5 low-risk offenders. It costs Douglas County taxpayers $200 a day to send a child to the detention center. This young boy was in detention for 6 weeks. We have chronic problems in our community in Douglas County. I can't speak to the rest of the state. In Douglas County, for youth who are sent to the detention center, they are sent back to struggling, failing schools. This young man's school, I cannot say anything positive about the school that he attends, an OPS school. It appears to be a warehouse facility for children that no one really wants to deal with. As this boy, I understand that Mr. Alexander and the staff at the DCYC are doing all that they can to educate young people that come into their facilities. But let's look at this in a common sense manner. There is no possibility that you can remove a child from family, from friends, from school, from everything they know, and they have no structure, although I realize it is a structured environment. And then when they're released, you drop them back into the school and shake your head and wonder, marvel why the child is not successful. I don't know who all is responsible for all of these systemic problems. What I do know is that the public should be able to participate. The public should be able to ask hard questions, not only of county officials, but state officials, NFC. These are serious problems, and they are not much better than they were in 2008 or 2010. So please help us attend these meetings and get the information that we need. The last thing I would like to say,
I have asked Mr. Klein, I marvel at this. We listened for an hour about very technical tax information, and I was here the last time those people came and spoke before this board. Where is Mr. Klein? We have an elected official. I don't understand why he's not here. I don't understand why he's not weighing in. I can tell you as a taxpaying citizen, I marvel that I can't even get a copy of the man's HR manual. That I'm probably, how many, Ms. Urich? How many public records requests have I had to make for a simple HR manual? Now, if I ask Lee LeJour for the HR manual for the county employees, it's very simple. He says to me, Laura, you can look online, or here it is. Why is it that the county attorney requires six public records requests and I'm still waiting for an HR manual?
Thank you, Laura. We will move to presentations, and I'm going to flip these. We're going to take presentation B, and that is the presentation and discussion regarding employee parking at the Douglas County Health Center, which was requested to be put on the board by Commissioner Mike Boyle. Did you want to say anything before we get started?
Yes, I just, several of us, I believe, received letters from employees who apparently, and we'll get to the facts of it all, but who apparently showed up for their shift and discovered that their parking had been moved, and then they had to start searching for parking, which has become the norm. And I want to know, you know, what was the thinking behind this? Why was the parking lot changed? What data provoked it? What brought it about? And that's what I'm interested in. I'd like to know what happened, because I think the employees, when it comes to parking, I think, you know, something like employees really, you know, there's almost an unwritten right in parking. The commissioners, when we come to work here, we have sort of quasi-assigned parking. I one day made the mistake of pulling into Commissioner Touche's unofficial parking place, and I lost some hair in the back of my head. But anyway, parking is very important. It's a part of employment, and I want to know why it was changed.
I'm not here to speak to that. I'm just a map guy.
Oh, all right.
Yeah. So there's your picture.
I thought you were going to give us a bunch of testimony there.
No.
Stay with the map, I guess.
I got nothing. I'm just.
Could I ask
County GIS? Yeah.
Could I ask Jim Turville to come up and tell us, you know, what these we've got? I hope you've seen them, but you'll recognize it anyway. They're overviews of all the parking. And thank you very much, yeah, Mr. GIS, for bringing those in.
Can you I got nothing.
Tell us what happened.
Certainly, be glad to do that. Jim Turville, administrator at the health center. What we're trying to do, and we've been working on for a few months now, is to create a policy or some kind of a plan for parking for the entire campus. And it's become more of a larger task than I personally thought it was going to. We've worked with Jerry Leahy, we've worked with Jeff McGill, and we're trying to also get the buy-in of the other county department heads as well in the various buildings on the campus, and have one entire plan for the entire campus. And that has been the goal. What we tried to do by closing those stalls, Commissioner, was to try and find out just exactly if they would find places to park elsewhere. And I'm very glad to say that there is plenty of parking on the campus right now. They're not, people don't have to drive around or park in the neighborhoods across the street, which we certainly don't want to do because we get calls from the neighbors, and rightly so. But they are finding places to park in the parking lot. And I think the letter also said that it took 45 minutes to find a parking spot, and that's not true. But,
okay, well, let's get to what happened. What lot was put off limits?
Okay. It was about between 20 and 30 stalls that were right adjacent to, how can I point out?
Yeah.
They're right here.
Yep. You can just kind of use that.
Okay.
Yeah, you can just kind of draw
it. It was from, it was these stalls right here.
These stalls, that whole straight line?
Right along that line. There are about 25 altogether there, and also along the center median as well.
Okay.
And it was roped off right across here to that end.
Okay, and where is the employee entrance in relation to
We have several
lot?
Employee entrances. There's one right back here.
Okay.
That's door 3. There is a new one that was installed, I'm trying to see here, here. That's the one that opens right down in the floor of the, or in the office area of the mental health center. That's door 1.
How many spaces were there? How many employees parked there that are unhappy?
Well, if you can assume that from the letter that had the signatures on it, I'd say it was probably about 30 or 40.
So that was all the people who parked there. How is it marked? How is it marked for them?
There's a gate at this end right here.
Uh-huh.
That the employees at, let me back up, security would go out and open that gate like 2:30 in the afternoon and then let the employees for that 3 to 11 shift to pull into those stalls and park there.
Okay, who was parking before 2:30?
No one. They were just completely vacant. It was all completely roped off and no one could park there.
Why is that?
Because they had to be available for the 3 o'clock employees to come to work.
Well, I mean,
see, the problem is we've got a shift overlap. We've got the 7 to 3:30 shift is there for a half hour and a half hour overlap with the 3 to 11 shift. And so when 3 to 11 comes onto work, the 7 to 3:30 have not left yet.
Where's the 7 to 3:30 shift parking?
They're parking in this lot right here.
Well, in the same lot, then?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So how many parking stalls are there?
I was afraid you're going to ask that, and I don't know that. Maybe Jeff McGill knows. I don't know the number.
So those spots were people who were had specific shifts at the facility who were coming in, and then there was an overlap of half an hour, and so there was
all of our shifts do overlap in the nursing department because there's the report
sure.
off and
so
exchange of
where material. They park now?
They're parking elsewhere on the campus. Let's see if I can get. They're parking over here. This is lot one. They're parking over here in the youth center parking lot. That's
okay,
lot
let's,
two.
Let's get a look at that.
Okay.
Right here.
Mm-hmm. Sorry.
Nope.
You run it for me, okay?
Sure. There's another one here, I think. This might
that
be.
That sounds good.
That gives some of the
yep.
other ones.
Okay,
and
good.
Then you can scroll down. I think Mike had all those.
Okay.
Okay,
and,
so if you'd show me where they were parking and then where they are parking now.
You bet. They were parking.
It's kind of hard to see.
It is hard. Steve, you may have to come back up and help me.
No problem.
Okay, we need to scroll down here for lot one.
Gotcha.
No.
And they were parking right along this edge.
Okay.
From, yep.
Thanks.
To the place that where they were parking before, Commissioner, is right where?
In lot one.
Right there.
Tell me the number.
It's lot one. It's in
lot
parking lot one.
Mm-hmm. Where they were parking.
And it's on
right.
the east side and the east center. The east half of the center median in lot one at the northeast corner of that lot.
Okay.
You
and
can
then
see
where are they parking now?
They're parking over in lot two, which is the youth center parking stall. It's also for the parking lot, I should say. It's also for the state office building, the building that is occupied by state workers. And that is primarily where they park. Now, there's plenty of other parking stalls, and I wanted to share with you. They're not as close proximity to the building as the stalls in lots one and lots two are. But over here behind the warehouse, there's a parking lot right here. Lot number five, that has overflow in it as well. There's plenty of stalls in there to park there. Lot number four, which is the parking lot that was put in with the Health Department Vets General Assistance for the Midtown building, and that's where the geothermal field is. There's plenty of parking at the south side of that lot, and they could keep parking in there as well. So there's plenty of stalls. They're not just right by the door.
Okay, and why did you move them out of one, and what kind of notice did you give them?
I did not give them any notice, and that was an error on my part, and I apologize for that. But this is the first response I'd received from any employee regarding the fact that their parking stalls were not available. So
where does administrative staff park?
Any place they can. Just
where do you park?
I park way on the back side of the. I'm the only one that does. On the back side of.
Lot three.
No, not lot three. It's right behind. It's right by the morgue door. On
by
the back
what?
Side. The morgue door. The door where the bodies
okay.
are brought into the
and
morgue.
Where's that?
Okay, just a second.
Which lot, Jim?
Yep. Yeah. Mm-hmm, please. It's right back in here. Yep.
Is that adjacent to the building?
It's right next, it's close to the building, yes.
So you parked close to the building and then you moved all the employees over to two, is that right?
That would be correct, yes. Mm-hmm.
Well, in private business, management kind of sets the tone and usually parks, I think, quite a ways to set the tone, but so you're parking by the door and you made them all move. Does that seem reasonable?
Well, I've been there for 21 years. And
that has nothing to do with it.
I understand.
Nothing to do with it. I mean, they need adjacent parking just like you think you do.
Mm-hmm.
So, I'd suggest if you had any class that you would move to number three. I'm very disappointed in this because we hear about these things and it's not necessary. You failed to notify the employees. And then, you know, you take advantage of parking right at the door. And I'm sure your staff does the same. And I think that's...
They do not, sir.
Well, I'm disappointed. Where does your staff park?
Any place they can find a place.
So they just drive all around and look for parking?
Yes. Well, there's, when they arrive, there's plenty of parking.
Okay.
There's parking over in Lot 2, which is by the youth center.
So they choose not... They don't park close to the building
at all?
No,
sir, they do not.
They go to 2. All right, well, I'll buy that.
They do not. I'm the only one. And then Sherry Glassnap has a reserve stall as well.
So I'm asking... Yeah, well, you're the one who did this with the people who work there. What do you think the remedy is?
Well, I believe that the remedy will be that we're going to be assigning people to parking stalls or parking lots.
Assign them?
Mm-hmm, because the employees of the Kavanaugh Care Center in the building over there is labeled lab. They should be parking in lot number 6. That's right close to where they work, and also the employees for the Kavanaugh Care Center, first and second floors, they should be parking in there as well. The laundry parks there now. And I think also housekeeping could park in that lot and make better use of the stalls over on the west side and the north side of the health center.
Okay, so who's going to be using lot number 1?
Lot number 1 would be for the employees. The horseshoe drive in front is for visitors and patients that come to the outpatient programs at the health center.
Okay, what employees will be using number 1?
Anyone who works the 8 to... Pardon me, sir?
Will the ones who got kicked out be able to use it?
Sure,
or?
Sure. You bet.
How does that change from what they had? Because they don't have a gate opening or something?
That's right. And we're not trying to reserve any stalls for anybody, but we're trying to utilize the stalls we do have more effectively. So
why would some employees get moved out and then other employees be put in?
Trying to find out just what the impact was and whether we had enough parking stalls and evidently we do not have enough. So
what do you tell? I mean, are you assigning people to park there, or it doesn't sound like you are?
We don't know that yet because we're just working on the plan. We're working with Diane Carlson and with Jerry Leahy and Jeff McGill on the parking plan as we speak.
Well, I think you made a mistake, and I think what you ought to do is go back to the way it was, because employees are going to be parking there, so why not have the employees who are working in the health center, just like you're having the Kavanaugh people in lot parking in lot 6? Just makes a lot of sense. It's adjacent to the facility. I don't know why they would have, you know, who is in 2? Are they the people that work from 8 to 5 or whatever?
Lot 2 is the health, it would be the youth center, and that's for youth center parking and also health center parking and also for the state office building.
So, I mean, the people who park there are what, the clerical staff and different people in the buildings?
Mm-hmm.
They're not, they don't,
right.
What hours do they work?
They vary. There's one that comes in as like 5 in the morning. There's others that come in at, say, 7, 7:30, 8 o'clock. That would be 8 or 8:30 would be the latest they'd be coming to work on the day.
So it's the people who actually care for the patients are the ones who park in lot 1?
Lot 1. Yes, that would be right.
Mm-hmm. And that's the ones that got kicked out?
The employees that were kicked out were the 3 to 11 employees. Yeah, not the 7 to 3 or the 3 to 11.
Why?
They were in reserve parking. They had a reserved parking lot for them.
So why don't the same people in the same class don't have reserved parking?
No one has reserved parking.
I thought you said they had reserved parking.
What it was roped off and chained off so they could have those lots would be available for them when they came to work.
So those people have to hunt fish too.
Everybody does.
That's right, but there's plenty of stalls to park in, and that's what we're finding out. They don't have to wait and drive around the parking lot for 45 minutes to find a place
to park.
There's
plenty of stalls, then why did you move them? You don't need to move them.
Because we were trying to find out just exactly what the impact would be on it for our parking plan, that's all.
Well, you keep saying there's plenty of parking, then why don't you just leave those people alone? I just don't get it. And plus, I'm nonplussed that you're parking at the back door. I think that's bad. That's the end of my comments.
Commissioner Duda.
Thank you. As I understand it, Mr. Turville, you used to rope off part of parking lot 1 and reserve it for the 3 to 11 shift, am I right?
That is correct.
So other employees coming for an earlier shift would find all these parking spots roped off and they couldn't use them.
That's correct. And I've had people express frustration with that.
So, and then in time for the 3 to 11 shift, we would take the ropes down and open them up for those employees. So those employees were given priority over other shifts for those parking spots, is that?
That's correct.
And now everybody's on an equal basis?
That's correct.
Okay, thank you.
Commissioner Morgan.
Well, parking's always a difficult task to resolve. I'm glad you have Jerry Leahy, Jeff, Diane looking with you. I'd just make a couple quick suggestions. I'd make sure on that horseshoe that you maybe put two-hour maximums or something so people know, you know, that they can't park there for all day. It might be a good idea, but I'll leave that to your group to decide. The other thing I'd do is I'd hesitate, but again, you can do as you like with all of you making that decision, whatever. And that is assigning parking sometimes wastes so many stalls.
It does.
That I like the first come, first serve. Mm-hmm. That gets me there a little earlier. I was a few minutes late today because I was at an airport meeting. But no one took my parking place here, so I still had it. But anyway, do the best that you can. And, you know, there's a part of me that thinks for sure on those 3 to 11, I like them, they're leaving at 11 o'clock at night rather than 3 o'clock. I like them closer to the building. But again, I leave that to all of you to determine because, you know, if I'm leaving at 11, I'd like to not walk as far in the dark as some of the others are across a lighted parking area. So that's all I have to say.
If I might add also, we do have a security presence out there at shift change. And also security will escort them to their cars, and they'll even give them a ride in the cruiser if they want to do that. So
thank you.
We want to assure that the employees are safe as well.
Excellent.
And it's great to have a reserve stall, but then it sits vacant the other two shifts, the other 18 hours of the day.
Right, and no one else can park in it. Or I run somewhere sitting vacant, too. That's why I'm saying I'm not wild about having, you know, a lot of vacant places because it's a sign.
Thank you.
Rogers.
No, Jim, we offer free parking, right?
We do.
Okay. No, I guess choice. I know, you know, parking gets iffy, but, I mean, you know, places charge, you know, there's places that have plenty of parking, and they make you pay just to be able to generate. So, I mean, I don't know what extra walk means on there, and I don't know what these particular situations are, but, I mean, you know, I know thousands of people that would give their arm to have free parking at their employer, and I mean, I'm serious about that. They, you know, so just to put that in perspective, I don't know what the walk is, but free parking is a big thing. Thank you.
Commissioner Kraft?
Yes, and I recall coming to visit one time, and the horseshoe was full. And I had to drive past those 30 vacant stalls and parked near the youth center. And I wondered why that area was roped off. Now, that happened once. I don't believe I was a county commissioner at the time. But then again, I don't remember when. But, you know, it makes sense to open it up since there is adequate parking throughout the campus. And with the security and the well-lit that you provide, I see no reason that we need to have why this needs to be a big issue. Yes, you have some disgruntled employees. When I was in business, I once in a while would have a disgruntled employee. It happens. I like your idea, perhaps, of assigning lots where it's appropriate, but only when necessary to assign a lot to a certain, you know, if that's close to their area. Yeah. Thank you.
Commissioner Boyle.
Well, you keep saying there's plenty of parking when Mr. Duda was asking you about, you know, all these things, there's plenty of parking. Well, I'm not really sure how that fits into the equation, but why do you have these, how many spots are vacant in lot number one? Why do you have them, why do you allow them to be vacant and for how long a period?
If you were to go there now, you would not find vacant stalls just because of the patients parking there, visitors coming and parking when the horseshoe is full in the front. Wednesday is a busy day of the week when we've got a lot of med students that come. They're supposed to be parking in the lot to the south of the Midtown building. And when we get our parking policy done and get the stickers, we'll be patrolling it to make sure that they're parking in the proper locations.
Okay, but how long was that under the previous situation? Why were there vacant spots? Were you saving them for the people who came in at 3 o'clock?
Yes, sir.
And
that's
when
right.
When did you start saving them? At
oh, my goodness. I've been doing that for probably, I'd say, maybe 3 years.
No, I'm not talking them? About that. I'm talking on a daily basis. When were they reserved? At 9 in the morning for the 3
they
o'clock?
Actually, the gate is closed at when they get off work in the morning.
Which is what time?
Which would be 7:30. If we don't need it for the 3 to 11 employees, we need it for the, excuse me, for the 7 to 3 employees. We need it for the 3 to 11s. We don't need it for 11 to 7 because there's enough vacant stalls then. So the prime time for that, for those stalls, be reserved is 3 to 11:30.
Okay, you're still not answering my question.
Okay.
When are they vacant? From what hour of the day till hour?
They would be vacant from 11:30 or 12 o'clock at night until 2:30 in the afternoon.
Why?
Because with the lap overshift, with the shift overlap,
yeah.
There's no way we can get people out of that stall, all those stalls, if they park in there on the day shift, get them out there before the 2:30 or the 3 to 11 employees arrive and need a place to park.
Who all is parking there?
Staff.
It would be any department who works at the health center.
Okay. Well,
and nursing.
I think it seems to me that you walk outside this building across the street over here, and it says next coming down by the parking garage we built. It says no parking 8:30 to, I don't know, I guess 8:30, no, not 8:30, yeah, 8:30 till 9 or mm-hmm. something, or 10 or whatever it is. I asked that those get changed. I asked the city to change those because it used to be 8 in the morning or something, or 7, which is ridiculous. Nobody was parking there.
Mm-hmm.
And if they made it 8:30, people could park there and come to court, So anyway,
sure.
That's what they changed. I guess what I'm saying is, why don't you have signs that say, ask somebody who knows something about parking and says, that these are reserved from no parking from 2 o'clock till 11 p.m. And then people will really get used to that. They won't park there. I mean, I think you made a terrible mistake at the beginning by not even having the leadership to tell the people who were not going to get to park there that this is what brought all this on. And, I just think there's a heck of a lot better solution than what you're providing. I just don't agree with you that you should have all these people walking from all these other areas at night and throw that responsibility on the security and all that. I think you've just made a nice situation into a nightmare.
Commissioner Morgan?
I was going to just mention one quick thing as a suggestion, only a suggestion. You could say parking till 2 o'clock. After that, cars could be towed or would be towed. You could try that, and then if someone comes there to see someone at 10 in the morning, they'd be able to park there for those 2 hours and know I need to move, like we have on different streets in Omaha, the 4 to 6, but that, again, is for your group to look at. Only a suggestion. Okay?
All right. Thank you.
Thanks a lot.
Commissioner Tusha?
Jim, you had mentioned that you're working with Jeff and on the parking situation, and you mentioned something about stickers. Can you
sure, it'd be a placard that would hang in the off the mirror post in the inside of the car, and it would say, like DCHC would have a particular color on it, which relates to a particular lot that they could park in.
Okay, so you're gonna try to set it up that if they work over at the lab, that they park in that area and all over.
That's right, to try and keep the other stalls available.
A quick question. I do know that on instances when people have hangers versus a decal on their back of the window, they do trade and let other people. Have you looked at the decals so that could not happen?
We have, and we do from time to time find out where they take the permit out of one car and put it in the other one. But at least we know who the car belongs to. It's better they do that than not put the placard in the other car. But we've looked at stickers, and we certainly can do that as well. Sure.
Because I know that happens. I mean, even if they have two vehicles, and they may only, you could always, when I first started, we had to write down on what vehicles that they would see in the garage. So that way, even if a person had two vehicles, you could give them the two stickers so that way you wouldn't mistake one for the other. Just a suggestion, because I know people do trade off the hanger thing. So I just was curious if you looked at
that. We'll take that in consideration, certainly.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you for the idea.
Commissioner Duda.
Thank you. One more question, Jim. If an employee from the 3 to 11 shift shows up for work on time and they find a spot in parking lot 1, are they kicked out? Are they welcome to use that spot?
In lot one? No, they could park there.
So you didn't kick anybody out?
No.
You just quit reserving and keeping those spots empty 15 hours a day for the benefit of the 3 to 11 shift?
That's correct.
And that's what they're complaining about?
That's right.
Thank you.
Commissioner Kraft?
And I want to make clear, I have no problems with what you've done. I actually think it's good. But regarding the comment you made that I responded to assigning lots, wouldn't people who work in the lab automatically want to park in lot six?
I think they do, but I don't think that the housekeeping staff does. I know laundry does, but there's people and also the employees who work in the Cavanaugh Care Center. I'm not sure if they park in lot six or not.
Because so most people I know want to park as close to the entrance
right.
as they can,
sure.
which is causing some employees to be disgruntled.
Mm-hmm.
But I have no problem with what you've done or why you've done it. And I just want to make sure that's clear because I don't think you deserve a beating over this. Thank you.
Commissioner Boyle?
Well, I don't agree at all with what Commissioner Kraft said. I do hold you accountable for the way you're treating your employees. I think that's part of leadership and part of what you're getting paid to do. The fact that you have your parking right at the door at the back speaks for itself. The fact you didn't even notify these people is a problem. And you said you don't even know how many parking places there are in this lot. You know, I just think it's it doesn't make any sense what you're doing. I think you can control it with signage. Like Commissioner Morgan suggested, that parking, you know, 2 to 10 p.m. or whatever it is your hours want to be. And if there's plenty of parking, why jack with this? Why are you doing this? If there's plenty, why don't you let the people who work at the building, just like you enjoy parking at the door, just like you enjoy parking at the door, why aren't they allowed to when they're coming in to take care of the people? I guess their RNs or somebody, their nurses, nursing staff. Now, the people who are doing clerical work, you know, I don't know what their hours are, but lot two would make great sense for that. And if you're accommodating the Cavanaugh people with lot six, why are you not doing the same with the nurses and so forth in lot one?
That's what we're trying to do. We're trying to move people who are parking in lot one to the lot six if they are working close to lot six. So we can leave stalls available in lot one for the people that work on that side of the building. That's what we're trying to do, Commissioner. Okay.
Well, I just think it's I think it's something that should have never happened. And parking is a big deal, and when you jack people around like that, expect to hear from me.
I think you're on the right track, Jim, in trying to figure out parking is an issue. And believe me, when I worked at a healthcare system, I parked in the North 40, and it didn't matter what time I came in. That's where you parked. It wasn't anywhere close to the building. Now, I've been out of that profession for quite a while, so it might have changed, but we were given a parking lot, and I seriously, in the North 40, and it didn't matter what season you were at or in or what time you came in. So it is an issue, and the biggest issue I have is to make sure that we have adequate parking for the people who are coming there for services. I understand employees are important, and we don't want to send them into any dangerous areas to which to park. But first and foremost, we're there to serve the people. So whoever is coming to visit, who's ever coming there to use our services, that's what's important, that we have adequate parking for. Then we go to move to the employees. And I understand your logic of opening those up because they sat empty for that many hours. And I also understand your logic of trying to see who is parking there so that we can possibly move those to other places, which makes more sense. So I think you're on the right track. You know, we can sit here and be Monday morning quarterback on any decision that's made and decide whether it was a good or a bad one. But I think we're on the right track in trying to fix a problem that's really kind of non-fixable because there's always mm-hmm. going to be an issue. But I think we're on the right track for that. Commissioner Boyle?
Well, I think if any of those spaces were empty, it's a lack of planning on your part and your staff. And I frankly suggest that anyone, starting with you, who's making over $100,000 should park in lot 3 and let the employees see you walk to and from there to set the tone for, you know, you're giving up your special parking place. I think you should do that. I really do. The other thing is, I don't know where the public, if the people who are coming to visit definitely have a priority. And I don't know. I tried to count the spots in that lot. Looks like there's quite a few, but I still don't get why you can't have an area that says, no parking 2:30 to 11 p.m. or something to accommodate the number of, and how many numbers are there anyway, 20-something?
20-something.
How many people are got thrown out of that lot?
I think there's like 25 or 26.
25.
Yeah, and that'd be CMHC employees as well as the Health
right.
Center.
Right, yeah. And they work right in the building adjacent there, right?
Mm-hmm. Correct.
Okay. Well, I just think you ought to, call it Monday morning quarterback or call it just interjecting ourselves when there's a screw-up, whatever you want to call it. I intend to watch it closely. I think this is a bad thing you did to the employees. I think it's not respectful. I'll be honest, very disrespectful.
Commissioner Duda.
Commissioner Boyle, we've been getting along very well for some time now, perhaps. maybe all good things must come to an end. We've got to give the leadership here a little bit of flexibility to try to address this problem, and leaving prime parking spots empty, roped off 15 hours a day, may not be the best solution for the entire facility. It's great for the 3 to 11 shift, but it may not be in the big picture the best way to use those parking spots. I support you in going forward and trying to figure out what the best way to use these parking spots is. And I also would say we have pretty good parking spots down in Level B, and there's a whole lot of full-time county employees who don't get to park in Level B, so we can. Thank you.
Commissioner Boyle.
Well, I'm sorry to have this go back and forth. If there's roped off for these long periods of time, that's his fault. I mean, he ought to be signing this in such a way so that it shows you open parking. And over next to the Orpheum Theater, there's handicap signs all along the block there, handicapped. And then it says open parking from sometime to sometime. So it means you can ignore the sign. That's what he ought to have there. It ought to say no parking from 2:30 to 11 p.m. All of the times open so that people can come and go. There should be no reason for that to be roped off and vacant, stand vacant when it's not needed. It's bad planning.
Commissioner Duda.
But it's been roped off for 3 years, and that's the change he's trying to make, and that's what we're criticizing him for, is taking the ropes down.
Well, so I'm saying,
Commissioner Kraft.
Yes, and are we saying, Commissioner Boyle, that we should never change the status quo, that we should make somebody who's visiting or there for treatment find it very inconvenient to find parking because we have 30 spaces stalled off? Do we want to be somebody who's towing their car because they are visiting somebody who's in the long-term care and overstays their time? I think this is a big to-do about next to nothing. And yes, you have employees who get their noses out of joint, and it happens. There are times, because they're so used to the status quo, any change, even in some cases moving one stall further away, can cause somebody to complain. So, again, I don't think Mr. Turville deserves this lashing. I don't think he's incompetent. Now, it would have been nice if he'd sent a letter a week in advance telling employees a change was coming. But it happened. It's not as majorly disrespectful as I think you're implying it to be. Most people are reasonable. If you give them the explanation, they understand. Now, as to Mr. Turville parking near the entrance, he's in and out and in and out of the building. With the if we're looking at efficiently using somebody's time, especially as they are compensated in relationship to the compensation and their duties, he needs to have access to that car in and out instead of paying him a considerable amount of money to walk the 5 minutes around to the other side of the building. Those 5 minutes add up. If he's in and out 6 times a day, and I have no clue as to how many times he's in and out, but you know, that's a half an hour if it's just 5 minutes, and at whatever salary you said, well over $100,000, and I do know your salary, but you know, divide that into the number of hours he works, and you're talking a big dollar amount. Yeah, to me, you're making a big, big, big to-do about a very minor incident. So that's my last comment.
Commissioner Morgan?
I was going to suggest to our Madam Chairperson that unless there's someone else that wants to speak that hasn't spoken, that they be allowed and we end the parking discussion. I think they've got enough information to do the right thing with the input that they've talked about. And they've got plenty of input from all of us, a little much more than you expected, but that's what I'd like to have happen, and we move on.
Jennifer.
Good morning, Commissioners. Jennifer Beisheim, Douglas County Health Center. The parking issue at the health center has
been... Excuse me, could you speak up?
Certainly, I'm sorry. The parking issue at the Douglas County Health Center has been ongoing for several years. Mm-hmm. When I took over the security department about a year and a half ago, one of my goals was to evaluate the parking situation and see what we couldn't do at the health center to make it better, not only for the employees of the health center, but for the employees of the youth center, the employees of the Midtown building, and most importantly, the patients and the visitors and the folks that we've got coming in for various clinics and things. It's been a very, very huge undertaking. I've worked very closely with Diane Carlson and Jerry Leahy to try to develop a policy that is enforceable, that we can use at the health center. Initially, the thought was that the policy was only going to be for the health center, but as we got into it and started looking at things more and more, we realized that we needed to address this policy on a larger scale, and we needed to address it campus-wide. As a process, we've had to, and Diane has been in contact with the various department directors of the general assistance and the youth center and so on and so forth to get their feedback and get their feelings about the parking situation. I feel very confident, Commissioner Boyle, that you will be satisfied with the end result of the policy. It is taking a little doing. I hope that we have it done here in, you know, maybe a month or so. We've made excellent progress. I do think that we could have sent an email out to our memo out to the employees to let them know that we were going to unrope it. We did not. That was a mistake on my part, and I apologize to you and the employees for that. But it is within the best interest of everyone that we get this put together and that everybody is satisfied with their parking. I can't please everybody, but hopefully they'll be satisfied. That is fair. So thank you.
Thank you. With that, we will move on to public hearings. Public hearing on resolution to approve a financing by Hospital Authority Number 2 of Douglas County, Nebraska for the Nebraska Medical Center in the amount not to exceed $53 million. And Joel Vanderveen from Kutak Rock is here to speak if we have any questions.
Motion to approve.
Second.
We're in a
public. Oops, I'm sorry.
Is there anyone here wishing to speak during the public hearing? Seeing none, I will close the public hearing. What's the will of the
motion
board?
Motion to approve.
Second.
Please vote.
Oh, he gets paid.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Joel.
Karen Kerstetter from the Nebraska Medical Center was here as well, so thank you.
Hi.
Thank you.
Karen Kerstetter?
Thank you.
Yes.
Thank you.
Oh, I'm blabbing.
Oh, yeah. I forgot. The other presentation was this unused prescription drug drop-off program, which Kent Holm was going to present but had to leave. And so this, if you want to pass that one down, it's unwanted prescription drug can be dropped off.
At my house.
and if you go to the site, that will be posted here. There will be a number of locations to which to do that on April 26th, which is a Saturday. Is that right?
April 26th. We need to start sharing.
Where is it?
But I do know that there'll be one like at 132nd and Center, and the Hy-Vee at 180th and Pacific are two sites that where you could drop these off. They have them quite often over the course of the year. A lot of times the Sheriff's Department is involved in this as well. But Saturday, April 26th, we just wanted to make sure that people know about this, because proper disposal of unused, outdated drugs is important, so that they're not just put either flushed down the toilet, or if they're thrown away in the garbage and then taken to the landfill, because it does have a direct impact on our water and ground contamination. And so Kent was basically going to tie those two together, but had to leave. So
what are the locations again?
Well, they're on, they're at the Hy-Vees, but go to the www.dea.gov, and they'll have a list of all of them that are all over the community.
Okay. Do they, is there anything in this, is there anything in the city?
I don't know. Go to the site and look. I don't want to misspeak and be held. we will move to, thank you for putting those up. We will move to committees, the first being the budget and finance, if there's anything from either of the chairs of that.
Well, we have,
we do have a budget hearing, and I thought, Joe, if it's okay, maybe 20 minutes after this, we could go up to 9:03 and start that, if that's okay with the other commissioners. And we'll have the Douglas County Health Center, correct, Joe? And we'll talk about parking.
General
Assistant. We took that off and changed it. Okay, that's Thursday we'll be doing that. But the other thing I want to mention that's important is next Tuesday we do not have a board meeting. But we are going to have some very important budget hearings at 9. If you'd like to attend, greatly appreciate it, your input. It'll start at 9 o'clock. Joe, you correct me if I stated anything incorrectly. And the Thursday one, yeah, we'll have also at 1 p.m. this Thursday. So anything else, Joe? Claire? You okay?
So, but today it'll be following this board meeting.
20 minutes after we adjourn. I don't know if we have an executive session.
Yes.
We do have an executive session for labor negotiations and potential litigation. Okay.
But it it'll be short. 20 minutes after that.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Okay. So then next is the human resources.
Sharon, could you print out the 17 pages?
And that's the weekly personnel report as presented by the civil service, if no one has any questions or comments on that. Next is the weekly CAO report on staff assaults, and Patrick isn't here, but did anybody want to?
There's nothing to report. Other than there was an incident at the jail that none of the officers were severely injured, but there was an incident involving inmates.
Okay. No other questions or comments on that. We will move to the legislature, and as you all know, they had their 59th day, which we're in the waiting period now until this Thursday, where they'll come back and take up any additional vetoes that may have take place and final readings of various bills that didn't get read before that. Important things, though, and it was mentioned today, that LB 464, that was the juvenile justice bill, was passed, and that included the arraignment court jurisdiction and various services for families, as well as the truancy. So we were happy to see that that passed with a 46-0 and 3 not voting votes. And then LB 907, which added and changed and eliminated provisions relating to the criminal justice, incarceration, probation, parole, and legal education financial assistance, also passed on a 46-0 to 3 not voting. So we were very pleased with that as well. We will be sending out later, after we have reviewed all interim studies, we'll send out all of them, but tag those that are of concern or affect county government, and then we'll also report in a couple of weeks what the actual last day brought, if anything, any surprises from the 17th. No other legislative items at this point unless Commissioner Boyle.
Well, I used to be a lobbyist registered, and I don't understand some of these things on the Kelly report at the right-hand side, for example, on the first, let's see, yeah, the first one, LR2CA, Constitutional Amendment. At the right, it says January 8, 2014, title printed carryover resolution, which means what? I'd like to ask them if they could put something in plain language that says will be considered next year or something.
Marco? I can answer, Commissioner. Marco okay. Martin. I was just going to say, I don't have what you have in front of you, but to me, that would mean that it was carried over from the first session.
From the first session?
Right.
So it's dead now?
So it was filed, you know, last year for the 103rd.
Okay. All right. I'll call the Kellys. I just think it's a little, session. The language is a little obscure.
Okay.
And I understand it's legislative language, but... okay.
We'll get clarification for that and send it out to everybody.
Okay. Yeah, I don't mean to. Yeah.
No, that's fine.
Like enrollment and review, ER-117 filed. I mean, what does it really mean? Does it mean that it's done and over, or is it moving on to something, or is it already over? And I'd be interested to know what bills, you did a good summary of the bills we care about, but I wonder which ones we missed on, too, so that we can... Yep. Kind of look at what we didn't get done and what we did get done.
And Marcos did send out our bills, and it's in a spreadsheet, and we'll be sure that we resend that out with that explanation that you just talked about, as well as the interim studies.
You're being so nice to me. You don't want to talk about parking anymore, do you?
No, I don't. No. No,
thanks.
I don't.
I thought somebody else would be nice.
I had your car towed, Marianne.
Commissioner Rogers.
No, Madam Chair, is this something that we can talk to the KGR about, whether it be this summer or sometime in the fall before they really get active? I mean, I think this may be the biggest mass turnover that we've had in a while, even though term limits just went through, of city senators from the area. And I wonder if it may be beneficial for us to, whoever makes it through the primary, just to work something out with them to educate some of them about the issues for whoever wins. That may be a reasonable discussion to have.
Mm-hmm. Yep, absolutely. There actually are a couple of ideas out there, and that would be another group for us to have a conversation with, most definitely. But I also think it would be good to try to loop back around to even those that are going to be there, because we're still a very young legislature. And with the last of these senators leaving now, it's going to be a very young legislature that remains. And so a good idea to have conversations with them. Commissioner, was that what you wanted, Commissioner Rogers? Anything else? We do have need for executive session, and so for litigation and union negotiations. Do I have a motion?
So moved.
Second.
Please vote.
Nice.
The Finance Committee budget hearing may not be till closer to 1, is what we're hearing now. There's a little power play going on here.
Motion passes. Are you a yes, PJ? Are you a yes?
Yeah.
Okay.
I thought the light went on, but the baby didn't stay on.
For purple mountain majesty above the fruited plain. America, America, God shed.